up with the only New Order town that seems like it could have been sung by the kids from Juno. I'm Ron Bennington. There's Gail Bennington.
Yo.
Now healthy.
Mm.
And I'm Ron Bennington.
Mm.
Welcome back, Gail.
Thank you so much for allowing me back. I swear I'm not diseased. I promise.
I was a little nervous, but since you were willing to put the leeches on to suck the poisonous disease out of your body, it's nice to see you back. You know, Michelle from with 1L wrote to me that she had the same illness.
Oh, my God.
Or maybe she brought it in.
Perhaps she brought it into this studio.
But no, nobody else from the team got it.
I know.
You know why? I get flu shots.
That must be what it is.
Yeah, I get a flu shot.
Because I was starting to think it was food poisoning.
Mm-mm. Like, you could take somebody with flu. And I did this with my neighbor. My neighbor was drenched with flu. And I said to her, shit on my face and I guarantee you I won't get the flu.
Your neighbor? You said that to your neighbor?
Well, you know, it's diagonal neighbor, if I'm being totally honest.
Okay.
We don't share a border at all, but I just said, shit on my face. I get a flu shot. Because my doctor told me that. He goes, with this, a fluish person can shat upon you, and you shall be fine. I go, shit my kitchen. I'm sure I'll be okay. We will get to street jokes in just a couple of minutes. So if you have a funny street joke, Vito's got some big prizes to give out today. He's very excited about it. The big street joke show will be coming up. That's the best street joke of all time. Gail, you and I did our street jokes last time, but this time, and in a couple of minutes, Jen will be doing her funny street joke. Chris will do a funny street joke.
Can't wait.
And so shall Vito. And if Connor's up for it.
Oh, my gosh.
You know, Connor's got the timing.
Today's Round the World Greg.
Oh, Round the World Greg is here today.
Yes, he is.
Well, he can bring us an Australian or a Chinese or, I believe, Israel street show. His dad is in the Australian version of the CIA and has performed many murders along with female assassins.
Do the people of Singapore have a sense of humor?
They are funny people. Chew gum and they hit you with a stick. That's fucking hilarious.
If you have clean streets, does that mean you have to have clean street jokes?
I'm sure they are. I'm sure they're that way. All right. So also, this is another giveaway we have planned for you today. We're at 2 o'clock. We're doing our Unmasked with the big gang from Crashing. Pete Holmes, Judd Apatow, and Artie Lang. Pete Holmes, Judd Apatow, and Artie Lang. That comes up at 2 o'clock. We have a signed poster by all three of them and what is soon to be the next Seinfeld. That's how people are talked. They go, move over 7 o'clock, Seinfeld. Someone else is crashing in your time slot. So this poster, and I believe it's the only thing the three of them have ever, you know, signed together. And let's face it, with an Artie signature, it's always valuable because you could be getting the last. All you got to do is go over to the iBang and sign up with that. That happens at 2 o'clock today. But I believe you can sign up now, Chris?
Yes, you can sign up now.
Wow. Yeah, I believe, yeah, you can sign up now. Everything makes him nervous. Everything. Everything seems, you know, it comes across as one of Trump's assistants where he's just trying to guess what Big T wants. Okay, I'm being told you cannot sign up now. So you gave me a solid answer, but not a good one. This happens at 2 o'clock, and we will remind you more as we go along. But for right now, have a good street joke, and you can win some big prizes. Now, Gail, I know that you're helping the what I call the back studio people.
Yeah.
You got Vito to get Vito to make up promos for these prizes. This could have ran all week. He's got great prizes.
I know. These are some really good ones.
Too good. And he just chucks them out the window like they're nothing.
For next time, we're going to have big time promos.
I like your attitude.
Thanks.
You know what I mean?
You know, it's a new me.
A new you. You got rid of all that other stuff.
I know. I'm lighter on my feet. I feel great.
Now, what did you want to feel like doing? Going out and eating ice cream sandwiches?
Mm-mm.
You're going to stay with soup and crackers.
Yeah. This is my new diet. It's the Hollywood diet.
It's funny. The only time that you have ginger ale, you're like, oh, this ginger ale is so good. I can't hold it down.
I was drinking orange Gatorade like it was like God's greatest thing.
Like it was grape Gatorade.
And I was actually thinking, why don't I drink this all the time? This is the most delicious drink.
That's for electrolytes. And that came from the Florida Gators. They put it together for us. I got to make sure I plug other stuff before we get into this. So 2 o'clock today, you're going to hear Crashing with Pete Holmes, Judd Apatow, and Artie Lang. Oh, yesterday. And I know that, you were ill, but we played that, Unmasked, and people went fucking crazy for it.
It was, so I got to listen.
Oh, you did get to listen.
I got to listen. I was at home like a listener listening and enjoying the shit out of it. And, it's such a funny Unmasked.
Nick DiPaolo is, brilliant. His new show is up on CISO. And if you just go to CISO and you write in Nick DiPaolo, you get 2 weeks for free and you get, or just DiPaolo.
Just DiPaolo.
And you get to, listen to that and everything else that CISO has to offer. Let me just look at these, some of the people that tweeted yesterday. Liquid Cowboy, I haven't laughed that hard in a while. Holy shit. Easily the best Unmasked I've ever heard yet. I have a new all-time favorite, hashtag Unmasked. Nick DiPaolo is my favorite comedian of all time. I'm laughing my ass off at Nick DiPaolo. Funny ass man. I'm dying with laughter. Let me read a couple more of these because they just went bananas for it. There's never been a funnier hashtag Unmasked, Nick DiPaolo. I was actually thinking that as it's going on. I'm like, oh, this has got to rank awful high. Isn't it funny, like, the thoughts you get? I'm like, this might be the funniest. I'm again at the road STD part when Nick gets rolling. It's really, watch out, especially when Jack and Water is in the mix. This guy says, this should sell a few CISO TV subscriptions. Jesus. Can't stop laughing. I just can't. My stomach kills. Like a desperate cry for help there.
I felt the same.
Fucking hilarious. Wish there was video. Blame that on Vito. Warning, don't listen to Nick DiPaolo in a quiet office. I'm fucking cackling like an insane person. It really was that funny. Congratulations to Nick, though, for his big debut on CISO. And I mean, like, we always knew he was going to be that goddamn funny. But then when you're in the middle of it, I'm like, Jesus Christ.
Oh, yeah. I had that moment where, because we've been, you know, in talks about it for a long time, like knowing that Nick's was going to be so funny.
Yeah.
But while it was happening, I was like, this is everything we dreamed of and more.
I was thinking that, too. I was thinking, oh, shit, this should be his third Unmasked. I was thinking we could just do that once a week at the stand. I'm going to be out at the stand tonight and tomorrow night, but tonight was some really funny people. I got to find them all. Your friend Tammy Pescatelli is going to be there. Christian Finnegan, Sherrod Small is going to be there. Who else is on the list? You got it, Chris?
Giannis Pappas.
The very funny Giannis Pappas and?
Adrian Iapolucci.
Adrian Iapolucci, who is very funny. And if we ever do like a Bronx version of Baskets, she will play Bronx Martha. All right, time to get ready for Street Jokes. Let's play our big theme song.
It's time once again for Street Jokes on Bennington.
A rabbi, priest, and minister walk into a bar. They say, is this some kind of joke? The premise goes too far. Jokes rock. Classic Brian Regan's veto from Queens say. Street jokes rock. Street jokes rock. Street jokes rock. Street jokes rock.
Street jokes rock.
Street jokes rock. Street jokes rock. Street jokes rock. Street jokes rock. I got some jokes from World War II. I tell them like any young men do. He was a joker and I am too. Oh, jokes rock. Yeah, street jokes rock. So find a joke, tell a joke, leave us wanting more. Street jokes rock. Street jokes rock. Street jokes rock. Street jokes rock.
Street jokes rock.
Street jokes rock. Street
That's not a street joke. We end with an actual. Anyway, that's really terrific, and it's fun. And you know what? Let's jump right into it. Chuck in Georgia. Chuck in Georgia. What's your street joke?
Today.
Yeah.
Gail, I'm so glad to have you back. I figured New Order was your choice today of music.
That was correct.
Nice. All right, well, listen, here's my street joke. Gay guy, a.k.a. Chris, walks into a bar.
All right, Chris Stanley, we
like it already.
Chris Stanley, right. Yeah. Walks into a bar and says, I'm really thirsty. Says, sir, we don't serve your kind here. He says, yeah, but I'm really thirsty. I'll sit at the end of the bar. I won't bother anybody. He says, I told you we don't serve your kind here. He says, I'm asking you one more time. I just want a beer. I'll sit at the end of the bar. Won't say anything to anybody. He goes, all right. Vito, big burly bear, comes walking in and says, I'm so thirsty, I could lick the sweat off a cow's balls. Stanley looks at him and says, moo moo, big fella.
All right, here we go. We are back in Trump America, where, you know, Chris, since this was about you and Vito, what do you think?
No, because I'm a straight man. No.
Vito, what did you think?
I think we need stronger than that.
All right, there you go. Sorry, buddy. Sorry.
I did enjoy that you used Vito and Chris. But.
I enjoyed that, and I did like Moo Moo Big Fella because, you know, I miss 19, let's say 62.
Yeah, and I miss those gays.
Yeah.
Don't
Big Fella.
Hello.
All right, here's Joe. Joe, what's up?
Hello?
Yeah.
Hey. Okay, here's my joke.
All right.
So the seven dwarves walk into a convent, and Doc, he walks up to one of the sisters. He said, sister, do you have any dwarf nuns here in this convent? And she says, no. He says, do you have any dwarf nuns here in this country? He says, no. He says, are there any dwarf nuns in this entire world? And she says, no. He says, aha, dopey fuck the penguin.
What do you think, guys? Dopey fuck the penguin. Is it, again, old school when we used to call nuns penguins. There's just not enough of them around anymore to get that joke.
It actually took me a second because I didn't grow up calling them penguins. But yeah. I do realize that that was a thing.
We did call them penguins, but never to their faces.
Oh, no, I would imagine not.
All right, Chris has just handed me a note. You have some production done for street jokes.
Yes, I do.
First of all, I'm blown away.
It's Street Jokes on Bennington.
Oh, Street Jokes Rock.
Just to let people know we're playing Street Jokes.
We just did that intro.
It's Street Jokes Rocks.
All right. Let's hear it one more time.
It's Street Jokes on Bennington.
Oh, Street Jokes Rock.
Wow.
So that could be like in the middle. Like, you could be like, and just a reminder, because we have the intro.
Yes. Yeah.
All right, so give me a case of where we would ever use that.
Like someone, like, tells a street joke, right?
That's
yeah. Like right
yeah.
there, right?
Yeah.
It's like, hey, let's make sure everyone remembers what we're doing here.
It's Street Jokes on Bennington.
So I say to them, let's just remember everybody what we're doing here.
You don't have to say that out loud.
Yeah, what would I say though?
No, you don't have to say anything.
No, I'm just,
should
I leave?
No,
I'd love to go out for lunch.
Oh.
It's Street Jokes on Bennington.
Oh, Street Jokes Rock.
Brian. Brian, what do you got, buddy?
Yeah, actually, Chris, do you remember blowing bubbles as a kid?
Yeah.
Well, he's looking for you. Oh. Boom!
First of all, the odd timing of that, right? Now, Chris, why did you yell, yeah, like you were in a sketch rather than a regular person? What do you guys think of the old blowing bubbles joke?
I'm not gay.
I liked it. I liked it.
Vito.
I need stronger prizes. I need stronger jokes for these prizes.
Oh, my God.
Vito sucks. Vito sucks.
Vito sucks.
Vito sucks.
Vito sucks. Vito sucks. Vito sucks.
I like that he only gets the one line, and he just eats shit on it.
It was horrible.
It was really bad. There is a, let me just tell you from a production point of view.
Yes.
There's a flow missing to this entire Street Jokes, which makes me so nervous about the night that we do Street Jokes live.
The best part about this is what he actually says is an insult to himself and right. the show. Ron, these prizes are terrible. What? I mean, no. I mean.
Do you know what I like too? Is that he shakes his head real hard as if he could shake that reality out.
Undo, 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 undo.
Like, and bring another one in. Vito, what would you like to say?
What I wanted to say was, I need stronger jokes than that for these great prizes.
All right, stop being furious. A, you didn't get the prizes. You're only the caretaker of them now. Okay? You had nothing to do with this at all.
Yeah, they were there. They were there when I started working.
You're the groundskeeper of these prizes.
You're the groundskeeper, all right? You don't go around yelling at people. You built the golf course.
You're groundskeeper, Willie.
I'm prize lord.
I wouldn't put you as a lord.
Tim in New Jersey.
Yeah.
Street jokes.
What do gay horses eat?
Hey! Yeah, we're not giving you one for when we all heard. Jim in Iowa. Your own street jokes.
Hey, that's me. Yeah. That's me. Welcome back, Gail. We missed you.
Oh, thanks so much.
These two old couples are sitting, the guys are in the living room, and the one guy says, you know, we found this terrific restaurant. I'll be damned if I can think of the name of it. It's the flower thing, you know, but the flower, it's really colorful, and there's the long stem, and the other old guy says, a rose. And he said, that's it. Rose, what's the name of that restaurant we went to?
But that's really cute, and I didn't see it coming.
I know.
I mean, it's not hilarious, but it's adorable.
It is cute.
Vito, open up your prize doors.
Yeah!
Guess what I'm sending to you? The DVD, Pretty in Pink, signed by John Cryer.
Wow!
I want that!
This would be the fucking time to hit your thing.
It's Street Jokes on Bennington. Oh, Street Jokes
Rock. Shouldn't it be something like another big winner, like, you know, like an explosion, another big winner for Street Jokes?
That'd make a lot
more sense.
Well,
the thing I do like is how abruptly it ends.
Yeah, it just ends out of nowhere. And wouldn't it be great if you just had John Cryer going, hey, this is John Cryer, and you just won a great prize on Street Jokes Rock.
And get him to sing it, you know.
Street Jokes Rock. Dude, if he fucking came back with the cast of Two and a Half Men, where it's him and Charlie Sheen and that weird fucking fat kid that they had, all singing Street Jokes Rock.
Can you do it, Chris?
Yeah, it's easy. Just do it.
I'm the guy with the horn.
What could be easier than that? Here's what I love about this. You see that we just did Unmasked yesterday with Nick DiPaolo, and it was the funniest shit ever. And then you two fucking ham and eggers come in with this production today. Just yeah. Kind of the ecstasy and the agony of the Bennington show.
It's the whole spectrum here for you.
Well, that was a great prize, and one I'd love to see in a promo. I really would. Let's go over here. John, Miami. Miami John.
Hey, guys.
Hey, buddy.
Glad to hear you're in studio, Bill.
Oh, that's nice.
Oh, thanks so much.
I've got an original. Look, up in the sky. Is it a bird? Is it a plane? No, it's just Vito from the ankles up.
He actually wrote his own street joke. Vito, what do you think?
He's going to take this joke to the streets.
I like to hear my name. I'll vote yes. Oh.
What are you doing?
I mean, I'm voting yes. I don't know how you guys are going to vote.
Chris, I'll give it to you then.
No. That's our
I'm going to say no because it is not
a street joke,
although right. I did enjoy it.
I just thought it was a tall joke.
Street Jokes Rock. Brian in Nebraska.
Hey, Ron, yeah, Bennington's out here doing today.
We're real good.
My joke is two secretaries sitting and talking. One secretary says, my boyfriend got me a dozen roses last night. The other secretary says, well, that's wonderful. The other secretary says, yeah, I'll have to keep my legs up in the air for 3 days. She said, well, why don't you buy a vase?
Somewhere there was a joke in there, but it was put together in a Mad Libs form. It's like a refrigerator thing. The joke was there, but you can't add the what about the vase after the punchline.
Yeah, I think it maybe wasn't told perfectly,
no.
But it is a funny joke.
I don't think it's good enough for the prize closet, but that stinger that Chris has, yeah.
It's Street Jokes on Bennington.
Oh, Street Jokes Rock.
And then...
a nice little fade.
It's almost like they're singing and then they see Viet Cong in the jungle. There's something moving and everyone stops talking. That fucking thing was weird. All right, let's go over here to Daryl. Daryl in Colorado. Welcome to Street Jokes.
Hey, what's up, guys? Yeah. Short and sweet. Hey, what's the difference between jelly and jam?
I don't know.
I can't jelly my dick in your ass.
First of all, I'm not even throwing this around. This is a straight prize closet. Because I didn't see that one coming on. I didn't see that one coming at all. And it's true. He can't jelly his dick into my ass. It can't be done.
And then I immediately just think, like, who do you tell this to? Who is the person you meet on the street?
From now on, everybody. I am going to be repeating this. All right, hit the sound for me.
It's Street Jokes on Bennington.
Oh, Street Jokes Rock.
That was going to be the sounder that doesn't exist, was the joke there, Chris. But
cool.
Luckily,
thanks,
you got your finger on the trigger, don't you?
Oh, yeah.
Vito, what does he win?
Daryl, for you, I'm sending Ice Age, the DVD signed by John Leguizamo.
All right, but he's a full-grown man.
All right.
All right.
John Leguizamo's awesome.
Yeah. What's that? What's that?
I love John Leguizamo. This is more about the autograph.
Oh, okay. Yeah, that's a good point. I love Johnny Legs, too.
Me
that's
too.
How close I am with him. I could call him
man,
Johnny Legs.
That's cool.
I go, Johnny Legs, what are you up to now? Do me a favor. Just take your finger off that trigger, Chris. I'm a little concerned about you. I'm a little concerned.
Trigger happy,
right?
Yeah.
All Street Jokes Rock.
All he did was yank out the Street Joke Rock from the other one.
Yes.
Go ahead and play it.
Thank you.
It's Street Jokes on Bennington.
Oh, Street Jokes Rock.
That's it. That's the end of it.
It's good. It is good.
So, by the way, the Jelly and Jam thing, maybe my favorite that we've ever had on Street Jokes. Now, we're already sold out for Street Jokes that we're going to be doing at the Fabulous Stan Club in America. And hopefully, and I just pray that this isn't the night that a Jimmy Fallon shows up, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Because then we're going to be stuck doing Street Jokes when he's there. Or it'll end up on The Tonight Show the following night. And he'll be playing with Betty White and Meryl Streep. I'll give Meryl Streep the jelly and jam joke immediately.
That's a classic.
Here's John. John, what's up, buddy?
Hi. Why does Chris Stanley make out with all of his Tinder dates? To get the taste of jizz out of his mouth.
You're giving away too many prizes, but that's great. Because it's true.
No one's snowballing me, Ron.
So I'm saying yes, you're saying no?
No.
Gail, where are you on this one? It's up to you.
I'm going to say yes.
You're going back in.
Damn it.
Third big prize given away on Street Jokes.
It's Street Jokes on Bennington.
Oh, Street Jokes Rock.
He's taking a look, even though the joke was about him. That's sweet.
They got the taste of jizz out of his mouth.
I don't like to get snowballed.
But that's why you make out with them. You can.
Yeah, that's what the point of the joke is.
Because you're not getting snowballed.
Okay.
You're giving the snowball away. You didn't get that?
I just don't want the taste of jizz in my mouth. That was
right, but I want you to understand what the snowball joke meant. And you weren't kissing a woman with cum in her mouth. You were kissing the man and spitting the cum back into his mouth.
Oh, shit. Now I understand.
Okay.
And I still say no to the joke. That they shouldn't have gotten a prize.
Vito, I can't believe we're giving away so many great prizes. What do you got?
Now I'm giving him the book.
No, wait, let me just explain to you about announcing. saying, now I'm giving them, is not a way. That's not a big announcement.
You know, we're learning. We're working all the kinks out now.
Can you imagine you're watching a major game show on TV and you just hear the announcer say, now I'm giving them, give it them.
Just listen.
John from California, I'm sending you all the books signed by John Hodgman. Not
what?
The books all signed by John Hodgman.
I thought this guy was getting every book.
He's getting every book.
Hodgman signed everything in the prize closet one day.
What? What are you sending him?
We have a book signed by John Hodgman titled All.
All the books signed by...
You are unfucking believable.
Dude. Oh, my God.
That's a great prize. John Hodgman is... hilarious, but I remember I did the Unmasked with him, and they gave me the book, and I'm like, I'm not smart enough to read this humor book. Because he's like a fucking brilliant guy.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, and I'm like, oh, what other books would I had to have gotten to get these funny jokes? How much more would I have had to study in my life?
And the name of his book is That Is All, not All. The name of his book is That Is All.
Oh, my God, Vito.
Well, if you look at the book in the office, Chris, it says All.
He's never written a book called All. The fucking name of the book is That.
You just
All.
Love being on fucking high horse right now, don't you? Play that stinger, buddy.
All right, we're looking at the... First of all, you are right.
Play that stinger, buddy.
This should be your fucking job.
All right, street jokes are for fun.
Yeah. What should be your job?
He should be playing with the booth with all this shit in there.
Yeah.
He should be able to play sounders.
That sounder anybody could play. Yeah. Somebody could sit and play it with their
He'll
fucking
phone. Do it if you want.
Phone. Now, we're looking at the cover of the book. Chris went and got it to make you look like an asshole. And you see a giant. That is all.
It does say that is all. But I still, like, the expression,
the books.
Our face, when it sounded like he was saying, all the books in the prize closet. Every book we've got.
That is all, John Hodgman.
That's a great prize.
That's a wonderful prize on Street Jokes Rock.
It's Street Jokes on Bennington. Street Jokes Rock.
Oh,
this is funny. I'm now calling Street Jokes Rock.
Oh, man, I really missed it here. Bennington is a fun place.
Yeah, there's no book that would just be called All. That would be the dumbest title ever. That is all. Very fucking witty. Very Hodgman.
We got pie on my face.
It's
nothing
egg.
New.
All right, let me also explain this, right? You don't have to say as an announcer that we're mailing it to them, right? It's about the fact that they're winners.
You will be getting overnighted to your house via UPS, all signed
by John.
The rest
of the listeners don't want to hear the logistics. We actually have an account set up with FedEx, so we won't be paying for the shipping. That's something that SiriusXM takes care of.
Look, people... dream of being winners, not mail recipients. That doesn't... Honey! I was just on the phone! I'm getting mail! That doesn't happen, all right? Maybe if there was Pony Express, bring up how the fucking thing is getting there. Now, how long have you worked in radio now?
Like a year and a half.
Has anything stuck?
I think today it's going to stick.
Can't imagine. Street Jokes has turned into a fucking nightmare. We actually need to play this game more, too. I don't know why, but the entire idea of a street joke has fascinated me since I was a kid. Because I remember the first ones I heard, I immediately thought, who's the guy who came up with this incredible joke?
Someone wrote this.
Yeah. And very big in... when I was a little kid, it was always the same premise of this little kid saw his parents naked and asked, what is that? And the parents would lie and give away, like, that's my, you know. And then the kid would get confused and say, I saw, oh, that's good, because I saw daddy eating blah, blah, blah. You know what I mean? Right. It would always be that thing. But, and... these went around like crazy when I was like in kindergarten and first grade. And I'd just be always thinking, Is it a second grader coming up with this shit? I'd love to meet this fucking guy.
He's hilarious.
He's unbelievable. Some of his shit is just, you know, there's a leap that you have to make, you know? All right, let's go over here to Michael, Kentucky.
So I was fucking this guy in the ass, right?
Yeah.
And all of a sudden my hand goes around and, like, I realize he's hard. I'm like, wait a second. This guy might be gay. I'm going to finish, and then I'm leaving.
Terrible joke.
Mm.
Terrible joke. Mark, what's up?
Hey, guys. Guy comes home with a duck under his arm, looks at his wife and says, this is the pig I've been fucking. His wife looks at him and says, that's not a pig. Husband says, I wasn't talking to you.
That's an oldie but a goodie. I love it. Here is Mike, Delaware. Street jokes.
Bennington's.
Yeah.
Guy walks into a pharmacy, talks to the pharmacist, he's looking for condoms with pesticide on them. Pharmacist says, nah, I'm sorry, sir, you mean spermicide? He says, no, sir, I want condoms with pesticide. Pharmacist says, well, that's a poison. Why would you want condoms with poison on them? He said, because my old lady's got a bug up her ass and I'm fixing to kill it.
It's literally... Chris, what do you think?
No. No.
Vito?
No.
I would have gave it to you, sir. I thought it was wonderful. And I love the accent.
Me too.
All right.
Oh, my God. Can't even keep up with that news. Let me just tell you this. This blew me away today. I hear that Trump, and this is never not discussed, he wants to send men to the moon by the end of his first term. There's another ship going up that's this giant ship that's going to go around the moon.
Mm-hmm.
And they go, why don't we just put some dudes in it?
Really?
Yeah. I was like, why isn't this being talked about? Why all the other crazy shit?
That's what he should be bringing up in that press conference.
I know. So, like, this is the third thing that Trump wants to do that I dig, except for I hear all the other crazy shit. By the way, I don't know if you can just stuff guys into an unmanned flight. I don't think it could be done. But NASA is hustling to see, because it's the first time anyone's been interested in NASA
right.
since, I don't know, fucking Richard Nixon. You know I'm a NASA fan.
You are.
Maybe this will turn me into a Trump fan. Maybe I'll be able to look over all the other crazy fucking shit. Michael in North Carolina.
Hey, Ron.
Yeah.
This one's for Chris, once he marries one of these Tinder girls.
All right.
But old man was at the bar, got so drunk he puked on his shirt. He went to the bartender, said, my wife's going to kill me. Bartender said, you've got a $10 bill? He said, yeah. Put it in the front pocket of your shirt. When you get home, your wife says something, tell her to reach in the pocket. She pulled up $10 bill, say a drunk puked on me, gave me $10 to clean my shirt. So he went home. Wife pulls the bill out. She said, well, this is a 20. He's like, oh, yeah, he also shit my pants.
Chris, what do you think?
You know, I'll say yes to that one.
Yes, Gail?
I'm going to say no to it, but all right, I thought it was...
Up to Vito.
I'm going to say no.
Ow.
Oh, wow.
Oh. You can just jump on the Chris Stanley train.
I like that I had a wife in this one.
Yeah, I liked it too. And I like when any joke ends with shit in my pants.
Yeah. I can see that happening.
Joe in Milwaukee. Joe.
How do you know Bill Clinton wears the pants in his family?
Why is that?
Because Hillary's balls won't fit in any pants.
Here's what I like best about it. The fact that you sound like a 1930s
guy. That's what I was going to say. It's like, it wasn't so much the joke as it was the delivery that I liked.
Yeah, the delivery was great. Let me just whisper this in your ear.
I know, it looked like I want to say this on one of the ladies here. I don't want to offend anybody, but let's you get see. It? She's no big bone.
Half in a ride, huh? Half in a ride. That guy was fucking hilarious. I guess that's the Milwaukee thing.
That was great.
We're going down to Chicago later. Let me tell you, some of those guys aren't going to be too fucking happy, you know? Still watching The Wire?
I haven't started yet.
Oh. I got into it, but when I went on my on-demand... There's one fucking missing, like in between, like, it goes from like 7 to fucking 9.
What?
Yeah. Street Jokes Rock at my fucking expense this time. We're going to give away, because we've got something coming up, one more prize, but I promise we'll do Street Jokes again real soon. And I don't want to give up the chance to hear this stinger.
It's Street Jokes on Bennington.
Oh, Street Jokes Rock.
People are writing to me, go to HBO Go. I don't have HBO Go. You know, maybe when my kids come over, they'll put in the HBO Go for
me. If you have HBO, you have HBO Go.
Where do I have it?
Yeah, it's an app that if you have HBO, you can sign in.
Yeah, I don't want to sign in to shit. You know what I mean? I don't like a bunch of apps on my phone.
You know what I got to get you? A Roku. Isn't the Roku the thing that, like, hooks everything up and then he'll Roku, have it all in the same space?
I don't know how the Roku works. Come over and fix the Roku.
I got Leslie on Roku. Loves it.
If he has an Xbox or a PlayStation, that acts like a Roku.
You know what? Well, then I'll come over and just watch with Leslie.
She'd love that. She hasn't watched The Wire yet.
Is that right?
Yeah, you guys could be Wire buddies.
Why, was she still watching The Godfather over and over?
She's actually really into Downton Abbey right now.
Oh, that's
Kelsey. Tell her if she ever wants to talk Downton Abbey. I mean,
all right, one more prize, and then that'll be today. But we'll do this again really soon when you hear the big promo that Vito gets around to making. Marty in Arizona.
Hey, what's up, guys?
Hey.
Four couples book a cabin up in a mountain resort, and they walk in. There's only two bedrooms. They're like, "Well, shit." We go, "Well, all the women will sleep in one bedroom. All the guys will sleep in the other bedroom." So they get doing whatever they're doing. They go to bed. In the middle of the night, this guy wakes up horny as hell. He wakes up the guy next to him. He says, "Man," he goes, "I just woke up with the biggest hard on in my fucking life." He goes, "I'm going next door to get my wife." And the guy says, "Well, you better take me with you." He goes, "Why?" He goes, "Because that's my dick you got hold of."
It's an odd thing. Why don't they just find a way for the couples to be together?
90% of street jokes are gay jokes.
Yeah, they're
a good
gay.
90%.
Yeah. They're kind of gay-based. Greg in Madison.
Hey. Hi, Gail. I'm so glad you're back.
Well,
thanks
nice.
So much. That's so sweet of you.
And yeah, speaking of the shrimp, you know, and that, I'm from New England, and seafood is so popular. What's the difference between a lobster and a crab?
Why don't you tell us, Craig?
A lobster doesn't get caught in your pubes.
True. But...
Nobody? All right. That's the quietest one. Bruce, Pennsylvania, you're on Street Jokes.
Good afternoon. So Jesus walks into a motel, puts three nails on the counter, and asks the guy behind the counter, "Hey, can you put me up for the night?"
I remember this one.
Nothing.
I chuckled.
Yeah, you chuckled, Chris?
Too sacrilegious.
All right, you can't be that
no,
way.
No, come
jokes.
On, Chris.
Lance in Louisiana.
Hey, good morning, guys.
Hey, buddy.
Hey, why can't Jesus eat the M&Ms?
Well, because he's got holes in his hand, according to Sam Kinison. Keith in Canada.
Hey, Benningtons. I love you, Gail. So this girl comes home and she's got rice in her hair. And her mom says, "Dear, you got rice in your hair. Were you just at a wedding?" And she says, "No, I was blowing this Chinese guy and he puked on me."
Chris,
I say yes. Vito?
No.
What is your name so angry? You don't get the joke.
I have a great last prize, so I want it to be amazing.
Sorry, Keith.
Okay.
I really liked it when the Chinese guy threw up in her hair because all they eat is rice.
I like how honest she was with her mother.
Yeah, they were. They were great together. Here's Matt in New York. Matt, Street Jokes.
What's going on, Bennington?
Hey, buddy.
So I'm having sex with a prostitute, and it's just terrible. It hurts. I tell her, and she says, "Hold on." She goes out of the room and comes back in, and we start doing it again, and it feels great. I ask her, "What did you do?" And she says, "I peeled off the scab."
Yeah, like a little gross joke there. Chris?
No, it's too nasty.
Vito, no?
I'm going to have to side with Chris on this one.
As always.
I do like that he told it in the first person. That's pretty rare for a street joke.
Tim in Nashville.
Hey, what's going on, Benny Tins?
Yeah.
Priest, minister, and rabbi are all on a ship. The ship starts to sink. Rabbi says, "Save the women." Minister says, "Save the children." Priest says, "Fuck the children."
You see, because they're known pedophiles.
Yeah.
No?
No.
Too soon? Chris,
too close to home for me.
Oh, boy.
Stacy in Tennessee. Stacy.
old man has a dog, and the dog dies. He takes the dog to the vet just to make sure, tells the vet, says, man, I need to make sure my dog is really, really dead before we put him on the ground. The vet goes, I understand. The vet reaches back behind him, gets his little Labrador retriever, sits the lab down. Lab walks around, sniffs at the old dog, and looks up at the vet. The vet goes, man, I'm sorry, your dog's really dead. And the old man goes, I just need to make sure in my heart that he's been a great dog. I need to make sure he's really gone before we put him in the ground. The vet goes, I understand. Puts the Labrador retriever up, gets his little kitten out. Kitten walks around, sniffs at the old dog, looks up at the vet. The vet goes, man, I'm sorry, your dog is really, truly dead. I mean, he really is. And the old man goes, oh, I'm okay, I understand. What's the damages? What I owe you? And the vet thinks for a second. He goes, $750. The old man drops back and grabs his chest. He goes, $750. The vet goes, no, you don't understand. $25 for me, $725 for the CAT scan and lab test.
No, guys?
No. I'm going to go no.
Too bad. You have the perfect joke-telling voice, though.
I know. I agree.
Yeah, it's more of a problem of material than it was delivery. Here is Joe in Maine.
Hey guys, so this guy goes, sees a hooker on the street, picks her up. He says, how much? She says, $500. He says, okay. Brings her to a hotel room. They go into the hotel room. She goes into the bathroom to get ready. She comes out and he's already jerking off. She said, sir, what are you doing? He says, for $500, you think I'm going to give you the easy one?
No. Oh, Chris, no?
I liked it. I liked
all right, Vito?
I didn't like the hooker joke.
That's so fun. Yeah.
Thanks for being as exact as you possibly can.
I didn't like the hooker joke.
One more prize for today. We're already 10 minutes longer than I thought we were going to go. Shane in Texas.
Hey, Randy B. How's it going?
Hey, man.
Hey, a three-legged dog walks into a saloon, and the bartender says, how can I help you? The dog says, I'm looking for the man who shut my paw.
I'm going yes.
Yes? Vito?
All right.
I loved it.
All right, there you go. Big winner.
You did it.
Vito, see if you can do an announcement here for Street Jokes.
It's Street Jokes on Bennington.
Oh, Street Jokes Rock.
Shane, you've won.
Yes, sir. Hey, that's
if
my
all the Raindrops United, signed by Judah Friedlander.
Wow.
Yes.
Huge.
That's a great prize.
That's a great prize.
All right,
great
let's play our big theme song and head to break. Coming up at 2 o'clock, it's the guys from Crashing, Judd Apatow, Artie Lang, and Pete Holmes. And you can go to the iBang, sign up there, and win a poster signed by all three of them. It's the town hall poster. It's a once-in-a-lifetime prize there, and only for this time. Street Jokes. It's the Bennington Show. And about half an hour, you can win that signed poster by the guys from Crashing, Pete Holmes, Judd Apatow, and Artie Lang. Make a nice present for a youngster or a loved one in your family if you don't want it yourself. So it's over at the iBang in about a half hour. Let's jump into what some of this stuff is happening out there. I would say this, for no apparent reason, seems to be the big story. Monopoly ditches the thimble. And it's got the internet furious.
I have always liked the thimble was usually my number two choice go-to Monopoly piece if the top hat is taken.
Over the race car?
Yeah. Top hat, then thimble.
And the shoe?
Yep. I've always liked the thimble.
Why?
Because you can actually like kind of play with it. Like
you can put it on your
You can put it on your finger.
This lets you know how long it's been since you played Monopoly, because there's no way you're getting on that on your finger now. Everyone acts like they're furious about Monopoly stuff, and they haven't played in decades. And that always annoys me when somebody changes, like they'll add or take away a flavor. People are like, that's bullshit. I go, where have you been for this company? They're dying for people to play board games. It's impossible. People got mad when they had like a credit card for it instead, you know, would speed the game up and you just zip this credit card. Well, the money's the best fucking part. Really? Do you play?
Yeah. And do you say that you'll be banker? You probably don't, because it is an annoying job.
I would always be banker because it'd be a little closer to the money. I'd be what was known as a crooked banker.
You always win when you play banker.
Mm-hmm. I do very good. I got a lot more money to spend on stuff. Like right away, I go, I like to buy 8 hotels. People are like, you didn't even spend the first time yet. What kind of banker are you? Crooked one.
Now they're doing away with our thimble.
I don't think a single boy ever wanted a thimble. I'm going to check with Jen, who's, she's our youngest. Have you ever even played Monopoly?
Yeah, I played when I was little.
And what would you take?
I don't remember what I used to take. But I just remember like playing, I don't remember. But I just remember playing with my friends like, and I remember when they used to have it like with the McDonald's thing, like the McDonald's and Monopoly would like sync together.
Well, that was just meant you went to McDonald's and you ate something. It was never a game.
You could win a Range Rover or something.
People, I don't know why, anytime like they tried the biggest, it was either the best thing that McDonald's ever did was the worst. But in the 84 Olympics, if people got gold medals, you could get free stuff at McDonald's, right? The thing was, the Russians didn't show up for the 84 Olympics. So we're just fucking running roughshod over the rest of the fucking free world. And people are just, you fuck yeah, they're at McDonald's. And it would be on TV and people are just like screaming, I fucking kill it at that McDonald's. Trump at a Boeing factory and he just called it boing.
Sir, that's not how it's pronounced.
Boing. Chris, what did you use? A hypodermic needle left over from your dad?
I want the works. I used race car and dog. Those are my two.
Dog.
I like the dog.
Because you're never allowed to have one.
I mean, first of all, whoever thinks of a dog as somebody that's going to be running an empire.
Yeah, it's not a good...
I would be forced to the dog, and then with the dog, when I would go by, I would act like I was peeing on the other players.
Because, like, don't they all kind of represent a type of business? Like, the thimble is, like, clothing or fashion.
Textiles.
The race car would be, like, auto.
Yeah.
But, like, what's the dog?
The dog would be the veterinarian business and the fact puppy pounds.
Okay.
Dog fighting.
All right. So let's go. What would iron be?
Service industry. I would say hotel management service.
That's a stretch.
Yeah, it really is, I think. Iron. What if iron? What are you typing away at, dude? What are you looking for?
What is the iron?
Are you going to see what all the answers were?
I was going to look up the other pieces.
Why don't we just have you just read Wikipedia to us? Just sit here and read Wikipedia. Instead of having a conversation, Chris wants to read a fun fact to you off of Wikipedia. Do you type in real life when people are having a conversation with you?
No, I don't.
Why do you do it here?
Because there's a keyboard in front of me.
We can easily take that away. Would you like to have the keyboard taken away?
No, I have to learn self-control. That's what I have to do.
And how long have we been talking about this?
It's not 8 years?
Happen. Long time.
It doesn't matter whether we're right or wrong. We're having a fucking conversation. That's the whole point. Redshirt in Texas.
Hey, good afternoon, buddy. How are you doing?
Good, buddy.
Hey, first off, yesterday that Nick DiPaolo unmatched is absolutely unbelievable.
Unbelievable, right? He's the funniest goddamn human being.
I don't even know if I'd call it an unmasked otherwise, other than just him riffing for an hour with you sitting there letting him riff.
Yeah, it was great.
I was going to talk about the thimble. Gail, I'm sorry, but I don't think I've ever picked the thimble. I think I would always pick anything before the thimble.
I don't think there's ever been a guy who's picked the thimble or the dog. They both seem to be very, or the iron. Those are the feminine ones.
The feminine ones?
The guys want a hat because it looks like, you know, Mr. Peanut.
Yeah.
The Monopoly guy wears the hat. It feels like you're running a Monopoly. A car, of course. The shoe because of Nike.
Right.
You know? Everyone's just like, man, that fucking guy at Nike makes a lot of money. Give me the fucking shoe.
It seemed like a broke dude's shoe, though. It seemed like a homeless guy's shoe.
You're being racist attacking that
shoe. You really are.
Type it up and see if it was a homeless guy's shoe.
I'm not.
I want you to.
I'm not.
I want you to type up and see if it was a homeless dude's shoe.
Not going
to
do it.
Again, I just like to say to the fucking internet, stop acting like you care about Monopoly or Archie. Like, people get mad when they go, oh, we're going to have grown-up Archie and Jughead's going to be black. People are like, well, never. You don't fucking read Archie comic books. Let them do with their products anything they can do to get a new audience. Because you haven't been there for them.
They have to grow with the times. Didn't we let you grow?
Yeah. We let you go downstairs and type. Isn't that fucking fun? Chris, you got some more details about Kim Jong-un's brother's assassination. I don't know whether you saw this, Gail, because you were sick.
Yeah, it was crazy.
Female assassins.
Oh, really?
Female assassins. One grabbed his neck, and the other one sprayed him in the face with some kind of crazy assassin juice, and he dies on the way to the hospital.
This is like some Black Mamba shit.
That's what it is. Fox Force 5 just got his ass.
So the second woman was, they're both arrested now. They're both in custody. Mm-hmm. One chick was grabbed with her boyfriend. And they said the whole thing, the entire time, it took 5 seconds for them to actually kill him. One chick stood in front of him and like distracted him while her friend put him in a chokehold. And then the girl that was distracting him sprayed him in the face with the actual chemicals. And then
why, if you know someone's going to be sprayed in the face with chemicals, why would you do a chokehold behind them?
Yeah, that's
I'd be on the other side of that fucking shit.
Seems like just a run and spray would have been a better way to do it.
Well, the guy's at the urinal, you come up behind him, you just spray him in the fucking face.
I mean, call me sloppy. I know. Like, that's just kind of the way I do business. But yeah, I mean, her face could have been in the... what is this chemical that is just... He inhaled it?
Yeah, they inhaled it. And then he, like, went to the security or whatever at the airport. He's like, I've been sprayed with poison. Please, get me to a hospital.
So it didn't kill him instantly. It took, like... A couple minutes,
yeah. But still, that's incredibly quick. Like, he was dead when he got to the hospital.
And we don't even know what they sprayed him with.
No, not yet, no.
This doesn't even sound real. Like, this sounds like something in, like, a Bond movie. It doesn't
absolutely.
I've never even heard of anything like this.
All right. Now what they said that they sprayed him in the face was just Raid bug spray.
Wow.
They probably sprayed him with peanut oil. And the poor little thing died. Tom, Wyoming.
Yeah, I always played the wheelbarrow. And I got to... Chris, how come you always wrap a hamster with duct tape?
Why's that?
So it doesn't explode when you fuck it.
Okay. That's good advice.
Coming up in 20 minutes, your chance to win the poster from Town Hall. Pete Holmes, Judd Apatow, Artie Lang. Just go to the iBang for that. Go to the Interrobang to jump into that. All right. Now, these scientists are claiming that they can bring back the woolly mammoth in 2 years. They've got whatever they need to make them grow their own woolly mammoth. Gail, do you think they should do it?
I think that they should do it. I know that that sounds weird, and I know it didn't work out great for Jurassic Park, but this is something, for some reason, the woolly mammoth
I'm
has been
I'm dying to see one.
Yeah, like, that's one that, since I was a kid, they were saying, you know, there are some cells, and if they figured out, that would be the species that they could bring back. And I honestly think we'll be able to handle them. You know what I mean? Like, it's not going to get out of hand.
How big is a woolly mammoth? Is it bigger than an elephant?
I think it is.
How much bigger? 10 times bigger?
I don't think 10 times, but I think it's a lot bigger.
Jen, would you bring back the woolly mammoth?
Definitely.
Now, you guys did see Jurassic Park, right?
Yes, yeah. I did.
You realize we're on a slippery slope here.
I understand. But I think we can handle the woolly mammoth. I think that we shouldn't go bringing back any T-Rex or pterodactyl.
Would you have a problem with this? Somehow hooking the woolly mammoth gene stuff up with a great white shark so that we would have a great white woolly shark off the coast of Long Island.
I mean, that seems like, you know, that seems like we're taking it too far.
This is the name of the scientific company that's putting together. They're called Do Us Dirty. I think that's fucking insane. I think that's insane. Hey, Jeff in Columbus. Jeff.
Bennington.
Yeah.
Hey, Ronnie, just wanted to note that, you know, off of your recommendation, I did read The Iceman. Incredibly scary book.
Scary
like
as shit.
Said, it scared the shit out of me, I'll tell you that much. But remember in the book, he would spray people. I believe it was like an arsenic mixed, like heavy diluted.
Yeah.
And then people would just be found, you know, that they had like a heart attack or some shit.
and you just keep on walking.
Oh, man.
Yeah, isn't that insane?
It's really creepy.
Now, I remember we used to mace guys on our show all the time. If we would have had, if our producers did a bad job, let's suppose they had a stupid stinger or announced how they were giving stuff away in an unprofessional fashion as we went here today. We'd march them outside, spray them in the face with mace while we're on the air, and all of our listeners would be excited. This was back in my shock jock days. I was a jock that shocked people. So we were doing the show from Universal Studios. They have radio studios in there. And, you know, we were doing a morning show. So we take our producers out, for some reason, mace them in the park. It just lingered there in the park. And the park had to, the park officials waited like 15 or 20 minutes with all the people outside before they would open the doors. Because as they said, we don't want people paying money and then walking through mace.
God. Well, you know, that Florida air is very heavy.
Yes.
You know what I mean? So on a humid day.
It was very humid that day as well. Yeah, you're right.
I had a situation in my school where somebody had either sprayed that or pepper spray or something like that. And the whole school had to be evacuated because it was just like so thick and heavy in the air that they're like, everyone out.
My biology teacher had some kind of chemicals that he spilled in the class, so we all had to leave, right? And then they had to bring in some, like, guys, some scientists from Sun Oil or something, who knew how to fucking clean up toxic spills. Oh, and everyone was like, why do you have these chemicals in the school? And he was like, well, not for the kids. Some other stuff that I'm working on. And they're like, why do you have these chemicals in the school? You're not allowed just because you think you got a fucking a teacher's certificate because you had 4 years of biology to have fucking chemicals at a school where minors are at. And so that after school, you can use the fucking lab equipment to sit there and put this shit together. He probably was making meth for all I know.
How uncomfortable, too, to have the, like, the professionals, like the real big boys come in and be like, you didn't know how to handle
they
it.
They were the only people, like, within 100 miles, who go, oh, yes, we understand how to deal with such a toxic spill. We'll be right over. Please don't let the children back into the school.
My God.
What you're doing is deadly. Rick, Saratoga, what's up, Rick? Or Sarasota?
Rich, yeah, Sarasota.
Yeah.
Ron, I don't know about the woolly mammoth and the great white shark, but how about a woolly mammoth and a male cow to make a woolly bully?
It's a great idea. Bring it down, big man. You know, could this be done? Could you just make the woolly bully or woolly mammoth smaller? That way we could use it for our dishwashers the way Fred Flintstone did.
Perfect.
It's a living. They would always have that thing. They were like little slaves, you know? What? Give up show business? They just look so sad.
Yeah, and they would usually have to be just like doing some sort of really difficult manual labor, like just chewing rocks. Or like there was like the little bird who a picture was just a bird who had to draw.
Yeah,
with like his chisel.
Beak. Chisel it out with his beak. I don't know. What are you going to do? Hey, let's go over here to Billy, Syracuse. Billy.
Hey, Ronnie. How's it going? Long time listener. Ron and Ron Days down in Tampa.
All right, man. It looks like Trump is heading down to Melbourne to do a Ron and Ron gig this week. He's putting it together. I think he's doing a wet t-shirt contest. He's got the Stranger Band playing. He's doing the whole thing.
Nice. Hey, speaking of Woolly Bully, what do you think about George the Animal Steel dying?
This is the first time I'm hearing this.
Oh, man. Is that true?
Yeah. 79, though. You want break?
Yeah, that's like 150 for a wrestler. But George Animal Steel, one of the all-time greats. Matter of fact, most of the time that he wrestled back in like the 60s and 70s, he kept his job as a school teacher. And when people would say to him, are you going to wrestle? He's like, I have no idea what you're talking about. I don't wrestle. He never admitted to the people that he was George the animal steal. And the thing that he did with Miss Elizabeth, where it was the Beauty and the Beast with those two together, one of the greatest things I've ever seen.
I had the chance to meet him. We met him backstage at a show. So that was the day that I got to do the Coco Beware dance and got to go in. He was backstage and he was like managing, like he was like stage managing essentially. So he was back there like in a suit. Like, that was the weirdest part, was he's like coming up to me like, all right, young lady, here's what you're going to do. He's going to come out. You're going to follow him out to the ring. And I'm just like, George the Animal Steel is talking to me like a normal person right now.
So yeah. Respectful.
Isn't that weird? Well, yeah, he was just running stuff. And like, if people, Tony Garea used to do the same thing. I don't know whether he still does, but those guys knew the business so much that they were just running the production of the, yeah, of the house shows. I feel terrible about George Steele dying.
That's sad.
Who did I see? Somebody says that they are making a documentary about Andre the Giant. And I remember the first time I saw Andre the Giant, it was in a wrestling magazine. And he was holding up girls in... four girls in his arms, right? He had four of them up. And I'm like, how could this fucking be real? Where is this guy at? Because he wasn't wrestling in you know, Philadelphia. Because everything what we got was the old WWWF, which used to be, I think, New York, Philly, maybe Boston. It was just along the thing. And the old-time guy, pre-Hulk Hogan, used to be Bruno Sammartino, who was just like a regular Italian guy. Wrestling, and he had been the champion for a million years, and no one had ever beat. Like, he had been the champion from, like, the early 60s through, like, the late 70s. He had, like, an 18-year run, right? With no other, you know, he would just always win. And he was in the middle of the fucking ring, he just won something, and you just see this enormous guy step over the top ropes, come in and hit him, and throw him over the top ropes. And I remember being a little kid and I'm watching on TV and I was backing away from the TV set as if I'd just seen an alien landing. It was this fucking, it scared the piss out of me. I'm like trying to say to my folks, Bruno is dead. Bruno Sammartino is dead. We may want to leave this area and get down south as far as we can go.
Man, there was like, was there anything better than when you like really wholeheartedly believed in that stuff? I still believe,
okay? It's still real to me, damn it.
It's still real to me, damn it.
Well, it's an action movie. You know what I mean? It's like an action movie come to life, you know? You could understand why children would love it. Shocking that so many adults love it now and the kids have moved on.
Well, I guess that was a fun phase, too, to like move into that thing where you felt like hip to it, but you're like, no, but I still enjoy it. Like, it's a show that I'm really into. Yeah. But, like, that time when you were, like, it was like believing superheroes.
Yes. Yes, and by clapping your hands, you can make the guy come back to life like Peter Pan.
I wrote a letter to Hogan when after Earthquake jumped him.
What did your letter say?
It was like, I hope you get better, Hulk Hogan, because I know you can beat Earthquake when you get better.
This was like 3 weeks ago, right?
I know you can beat him.
I know you can, Hulk.
Aw, little baby Chris.
Who
Stanley?
Stomped on Jake's snake and killed him? Like, it was in the bag?
It was like,
was that
someone,
Earthquake that,
yeah,
came,
I was
going to
say,
splash?
I think it was Earthquake jumped, yeah, on the snake.
Earthquake was a great heel.
Well, Earthquake was one of those people that never played face at all. You know what I mean? Like, sometimes, you know, most of the guys, right, go back and forth. I can't ever remember thinking, go, Earthquake, you can win this. Earthquake is a good guy.
And Bill Simmons is producing an Andre the Giant documentary.
Oh, Jesus Christ. So it's just going to be Bill talking.
Yeah, for HBO.
Up on the iBang, this is starting a bunch of trouble all over the internet. Rolling Stone's top stand-up list of all time. And it always infuriates people.
If you make a list, you're in trouble.
Well, it's a troll. It's a troll to make a list. It's also ridiculous to say, here's the best of all time, and pick so many people that are in their 30s now. You know what I mean?
Right.
Like, You can't go into the Hall of Fame until you've had an entire career. And then, like, you can forget. I don't think there's a comedian now who was ever as big as Bob Hope at his peak. You know, he had TV shows, he had movies, he toured the world. Every GI had seen him. Now, I get when you watch now, you're like, I don't see what's funny about this. Well, because it's not 1947.
Right.
But at the time, he was enormously big.
Most humor is dated that way.
Well, and you know, Woody Allen sits around and talks about Bob Hope as if, you know, he saw the genius. So how can you say, oh, why don't you just say the best people working today?
Right.
You know?
People we like and want you to check out.
But any list, doesn't any list just make everyone furious no matter what it is?
No one's ever happy with it.
I guess the person who made the list is kind of happy.
They're happy that people are getting angry. I don't think they're happy about how they've made the list. They're just like, I'm going to piss so many people off with this list.
I think that the list was done.
It's published.
Love a listicle.
Now, what's the difference between a list and a listicle?
It's just a fake article.
Oh. It's fake news.
So who are the modern day people that they're putting on greatest of all time?
Amy is up there. And, you know, it's probably a little too Louis C.K., Bill right. Burr. Basically, 2005 Opie and Anthony has done it. Patrice O'Neill did incredibly well. And, I mean, Patrice never got that kind of acceptance during his lifetime.
Yeah.
But he's like, where's he located?
32.
He would have loved to have done a theater tour, you fucking pricks. You know what I mean? Like, he sat around all the time going, what the fuck? Now you're saying, oh, 32 of all time. It always drives me nuts, though. Because, again, Groucho Marx was gigantic. And, you know, the biggest movie star, then the biggest TV star. What was the other, Milton Berle, you know, gigantic.
And maybe it's just reflecting back on that time, but doesn't it always seem like, oh, everyone of that time loved that artist? Like, maybe it's just because we're, you know, you're in present day. Yeah. And so you're like, oh, there's all different types of comedy and people are into right. all different types of things. But whenever I think back on that era of comedy, I think of just like everyone's sense of humor liked this one type of comedy. Like they decided this right. is what comedy looked like.
And again, Billy Crystal was enormously big in the 80s and 90s. I don't think, did he make the list? Well, it gives you a chance to type.
No, he did not.
I knew you would love a chance to type. You too. You love to type. It's not a bad thing that like to type. You could be a typist.
I don't want
to
be a typist. It's just
take a letter, Chris Stanley.
How many?
Dear Hulk Hogan, I know that you're better now. So why haven't you written me back? Earthquake sent me a goddamn package. look who it is. It's Hard Rock Johnny. Johnny
Bennington.
Johnny
from the Hard Rock.
It's me. Gail, good to hear you back. I'm glad you're here.
Thanks, Johnny.
This list is ridiculous.
All this stuff.
Aren't they, though? You know, it's like, you know, number one guitars. I mean, this is just to get them people talking about fucking Rolling Stone, let's face it.
Yeah.
And it works. There's no way Eddie Murphy is number 25 all time.
No, it's crazy. Eddie Murphy was like Elvis, the fucking stand-up comic. He actually took his scarf off and threw them to women and they would faint.
And Dangerfield at 26, even. I mean, come on.
Did Rickles make the list?
I don't think I saw him on here.
No, he did not.
That's fucking insane.
Is, like, Lenny Bruce on the list?
Lenny Bruce is on the list.
They love to put Lenny Bruce on the list.
He's third.
Yeah, of course he is. Now, in the meantime, try to find a fucking album where Lenny Bruce is talking and people are laughing. No, I'm not talking about
that. You're just upset at the list. That's
yeah, you know
all
what? I'm mad at the list, not
He's
Lenny.
He's just upset at the list.
Right.
Now, here's a question. Did they put Cosby on there?
Yeah, of course.
Yeah, they did.
They did put him on.
He's number one.
Number eight.
All right. There is, first of all, Lenny Bruce and Cosby were contemporaries, right?
Mm-hmm.
Cosby in the 1960s was gigantic. long before his fucking TV show. Then in the 70s, Cosby was gigantic. The 80s, now we're into fucking super gigantic. So there's fucking 30 years of this guy that everybody agreed at the time was the funniest thing that ever happened. So where was he going?
Eighth.
How many points did they take off for rape? That's what I want to know.
Seven points.
See, why is he fucking T.O. now? It's insane. I'm trying to think of people that were, you know, like Tootie Fields belongs on this list. I think they put Moms Mabley on the list, though, right?
Yeah, she's up at the top. Like, top meaning the bottom, really.
39th.
She was really fucking funny. And very subversive. Like, she was doing cop jokes. Like, cops versus black people before anyone even thought, like, oh, my God, they are tougher on black people. You know what I mean? And I don't know whether you know this about Mom. So she came out and did she was doing the old lady, Moms Mabley, when she was in her 20s, right?
Yeah.
And she would dress like a bag woman and shit. Then, after the show, she put on a nice fucking suit, tailored suit, went out and picked up chicks before anybody was fucking. And that,
wow.
And everybody in the circuit knew that was her thing.
But it wasn't like an out thing. It was just
there was no out thing.
Yeah.
There was fucking no one knew Paul Lynn was gay. That's how fucking stupid America was.
Why didn't you know?
Yeah.
How is Sam Kinison number 37, by the way?
Where would you put him?
I would say top 10. He exploded and was there for quite a while.
I don't know if I'd say quite a while. He had a couple years that he was definitely... but yeah, Hicks moves up before him, right? Where's Hicks?
Hicks is 13th.
But Hicks never played theaters in this country, really.
Yeah.
Matter of fact, when we went back and did the thing on Hicks, he was even having trouble getting stage time in New York after he had albums out and shit.
And just as an FYI, Don Rickles is number 23.
All right, Chris.
On the list.
Oh, 23 is pretty fucking good.
Still not decent, but
that's pretty fucking good. Although I gotta tell you, I don't know if there's 22 people who go, I'm funnier than Rickles. Where's Phoebe Cates on this list?
Not on the list, oddly enough.
He legitimately looked it up, though.
Of course he did. He loves the type.
All right. What's your words per minute?
65.
Where's Artie Lang on this list? Where's Judd Apatow on this list?
Hold on, I'm
Pete
typing.
Where's Holmes on this list? I'll tell you what, you can get their signed poster going over to the iBang now and just signing up for it. That's the signed town hall poster. I'm going to try to win it myself.
That's a collector's. You should.
Yeah.
I would like to win that, and someone could just come randomly drop it off for me and leave it in my mailbox, like my Bennington Thanksgiving poster I got. So whoever did that, thank you.
That was Jen.
Jen, you took care of it.
Thank you.
No problem.
First of all, it wouldn't have been Chris.
We're almost at St. Patrick's Day. Why would it take the guy who hosted it and promoted us this long to get it?
That was my fault.
It's all right, I got it now. It's nice.
Do you want to get that tattooed? That was my fault. You know, I have to tell the truth, though, because, you know, I bust Chris's balls a lot. But a lot of people ask me, who's the greatest producer I've ever had? Who else is up on that list there?
Who would that be?
Who, by the way, what's that pictures of?
That's pictures of the guys from Mystery Science Theater 3000.
Oh.
Leslie Kaufman wrote an article on them, the iBang.
Oh, great. I didn't know about that. What else is up on the iBang? On the front page today.
Dick DiPaolo unmasked.
Mm.
Colbert edging out Fallon.
Yeah.
Chelsea announcing season 2 plans.
Where's the comedy junkie at today?
Oh, notes from a comedy junkie. 36 hours in NYC with Gina Bisconti, Judd Apatow, Pete Holmes, Artie Lang, and Bennington.
Mm. Oh, nice.
By Sarah Doms.
Well, Sarah came in at the... time of her life.
Whirlwind trip.
Mm-hmm. No, I didn't know that she was a major Pete Holmes and Gino Bisconte fan. And she is. Of course, we knew that she was a Judd Apatow fan and listened to Artie on Stern for many years. But this is what she sent us a note. She was so... Now, you have to remember, when we met her, she was a fan. And I'm like, oh, you should be writing this stuff up. And she was like, oh, geez, they don't want to see any of my writing, mister. She had her little hat on backwards and stuff. I go, we're going to clean you up and make you into a big, famous writer. So today, she writes, she was so excited. Gino Visconti retweeted her. Judd Apatow retweeted her.
Wow.
And I think Pete Holmes did as well.
That's awesome.
So you go from a fan to like, Judd Apatow has read my writing. It's very exciting for people.
That's awesome. That's very cool.
I'll never forget. Gee, mister, nobody wants to read my writings.
And you saw it in her. I was like, get this street urchin away. And you're like, hold on a minute.
Do you remember when we were all street urchins at one time? Just urchining around in the street, walking sideways like urchins. Perhaps we could do something with her. Obviously, we'll have to change her name. Her name right now is Flash Funny Lady. Let's get rid of that. But, all right, Johnny?
Bennington's?
I hope to see you soon, my friend.
Next week.
Are you bringing the wife of Derek Jeter with you?
I may. I thought you were going to ask about lunch, but I could bring, try to bring, I could definitely bring lunch. I don't know if I can bring Hannah this time.
What are you coming in to promote, Johnny?
Nothing. Friendship. Just going to come and hang out.
Aww, promote friendship. That is so great.
That's exactly it. I don't need to promote nothing.
Gee, I don't need to promote nothing, fellas.
Get this street rat out of here.
Street rat? Why, give me 15 days with her. And I'll turn her into the finest comedy writer known today. Since there's only six. I'll make her a top six comedy writer. When I think of all the people I found in the gutter and left them there over the years. Jokes rock.
That's been stuck in my head, too.
Oh, good. Trump's on TV.
Oh, I was worried.
He's on TV more than Regis.
I mean, he is on TV a lot of the time.
He just said, and I don't know why he said this, he goes, I could tear three phone books together with my bare hands.
Come on, now how's this news?
So, did you see that fucking guy who caught him yesterday, right? So he's up there going, I had the biggest electoral college win since President Reagan. Nobody could believe it. Since President Reagan, it was the biggest. So the guy raises his hand, he goes, look, here are the numbers that Obama got, and they're much larger. And Trump goes like this. Well, what I meant was Republicans, right? So there was no reason. He had never once said, I'm the biggest Republican winner since fucking Reagan, since there's only been two since then. And then the guy goes, George H.W. Bush had 400 and some votes the fucking first time in. And he goes, look, I just know what I've been told. Like, the facts don't matter. I just saw, like, any other president be like, Flintstone, get in here. I mean, if we did that, somebody would be yelling at us.
Oh, yeah.
He just doesn't give a fuck. You got to really admire somebody who doesn't give a fuck about anything.
One of my most favorite cringy moments is when he said to the black reporter, why don't you schedule a meeting with the black caucus? You know them? It's like, no, I'm just a black woman. I don't
Right, but you're a black woman here in the United States, and all you people get together at night and do Dixieland jazz.
I mean, I'm just asking you a question. He's like, well, why don't you set up the meeting? You know him so well.
The next time that you're out at the soul food restaurant, why don't you all?
Like, it was so cringy and hilarious.
And great, yeah.
And great. Yeah, I mean, it was...
the best.
It was actually pretty entertaining, that moment.
He's always entertaining. You can't ever take that away from him.
By the way, we got a message from big star Tom Sharpling saying, best producers you've ever had, Billy Staples for life.
Well, Billy was an alcoholic, I'll just say drunk driver. And he did win over Chris.
Yeah, for a decade.
We should go back and buy some of those tapes when Billy was fucking drunk on the air. It was frightening.
You like to have a little drink.
I haven't talked to him in years. And I called him once, you know, since the accident and then later orange jumpsuit phase of his life. I haven't talked to him too much. But I was talking to him, and I'm like, why don't you come in and do the show? And he said, taking an elevator might make him faint.
Oh, really?
Yeah, because he's Billy Staples. And then he goes, ah, oh, man, this was sometimes in radio, right, buddy? I go, they really were. We had a lot of fun. He goes, don't you miss it? And I go, well, I'm still doing it every day. I'm still doing it every single day. But he was hilarious when he didn't mean to be.
Yeah, he was very funny.
No, this is also the difference. He was a producer that never got off the phones. He only worked the phones the entire time. But
really?
We've never had anyone. I mean, in New York, we used to just push phones, phones, phones. He would do, you know, 1,000 calls. And he actually, and I never could get this team to figure it out, how to screen the calls as a phone screener. He would not let a call go through that wasn't pushing the show ahead, and then would try to guess where the show was going and have calls lined up for that. He was dedicated. He would be sweating like an animal just doing the phones. And then, of course, he fought 10 men in one night in Digstown Challenge in New Jersey. It was one of my favorite things. Because and the reason why we did this, I just watched Digstown Challenge on HBO. And I go, Billy, do you think you could box 10 guys in one night? And he's like, yeah, I definitely could. I go, have you ever boxed before? And he says, no. And then we didn't even, we just like sign up if you want to fight him like it was an old carnival.
Oh my God.
So like the first guy he goes the whole fucking time with, he's doing fucking really good. He's just in there throwing leather, letting guys punch him and shit. It was like Homer Simpson.
Yeah.
And then I think we're like 7 or 8 guys into this, and the fucking crowd was like bloodthirsty animals. Hard Rock Johnny got knocked out that night, so Hard Rock Johnny got in, and some big fucking dude just slammed him. Because Johnny had boxed somewhere, I don't know, in college or something. So Billy Staples, it's like his 7th or 8th fight, his round, and we're trying to, you know, break it up by doing stuff in between and all. And he goes out there, and these were like, I forget, 1 or 2 minute rounds or whatever. And a fucking guy hits Billy, and like he goes backwards, and you just see him sprawled out like in an old movie, right?
Just like in starfish pose.
Yeah, yes, total starfish, right? And the place is going wild, right? Now I know that the bit isn't going to be over because we got like 3 more fights, and I'm going like this. Like, it's like, 1, 2, and I'm saying to the kid, hit the fucking bell. Hit the bell right now. And they hit the bell, and I start going, what? Why is this bell ringing? And I point at a blank fucking wall. And I'm like, the judges are telling us that he went the full time of the round. And everyone is screaming at a blank wall. They're furious, but they think there's got to be someone over there. And I'm like, this is bullshit. Fuck this. All right, folks, I guess there's nothing we can do about it. We're going to throw some water on him. And we got 3 more fighters. And it was something like 45 seconds before that fucking dude hit him. And this guy honestly looked like a truck with some fucking just boxing gloves. I mean, it was amazing. The guys from Jersey just came out as thick could be.
And I love the idea of just like, yeah, I'll sign up. Like, just an everyman just being like, I'm in. I'll fight this guy.
Then the headlining match was Al Dukes, who is now Boomer and what's his name?
Carton.
Boomer and Carton show. He's on that. I just saw him at the supermarket. I mean, the Super Bowl, not the supermarket. So they're doing a thing where they're down, and Boomer Esiason throws the ball at Al like Boomer is a fucking retired pro, right? And Al is just a kid from Jersey. And you just see his little fingers crumble, and he's fucking yelling at Boomer like, you did that on purpose. So you said you wanted to see it. What's the big deal? You know what I mean? But, like, people don't realize catching a football thrown by a pro quarterback is fucking hurts. It literally, it hurts pros. It hurts their hands. It's thrown so hard. So it was Al Dukes against Black Earl Douglas, who we all know and love. And in that fight, they were fighting for the master's degree that Earl had, that Al had earned in his college education. He had a master's degree in communications, right? So he had to bring in his master's degree. Well, he got a terrible flu. I mean, an awful fucking flu. So bad. And he's laying backstage. He's like, I don't know if I can do this. I'm like, I know you can, buddy. I know if anybody can do this, you can. He goes, I can't go out there and beat Earl. I go, look, you don't have to beat Earl. You just have to go out there. Whatever happens, happens. So they go out, and Earl just fucking beats the shit out of him. Takes his master's degree and tears it up in front of the audience while they're going crazy. These bloods, they're just fucking screaming like it's the best thing they've ever seen. We put, you know, as Al's laying on the ground, I'm like, you did it, buddy. You did all we could ask of you. We're putting him in the ambulance, right? These fucking listeners gather around the ambulance and start to rock it as they're screaming a word that you could say in the early 2000s. You really shouldn't say now. Let's just say F word, F word, gotcha. F word. But it's rocking back and forth. And then I'm like, up there, there he goes, everybody. Al Dukes, he's a real hero. We got to give him everything for this. I remember leading up to that, we were just saying that, you know, we were getting both of them the punch. So I put my hands up. And I'm like, hit my hands, dude. And he said, I go, you hit like fucking nothing. You're not going to be able to, I'm saying to Al Dukes. And he punches, and it just, like his knuckle hit a nerve in the bottom of my hand.
Yeah, there's like a little nerve there.
And I felt my whole nerve, my whole arm go numb. And I felt like I was going to puke when I'm on the air. And I just go like this. Let's just, because I'm like a fucking asshole. That won't give him the benefit of, oh, that really hurt.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? I just hide it. Let's go to break now, shall we? And then, like, I go to break, and I go, am I going to throw up on the floor? I just walked around until it started to feel better. But that catching that nerve thing.
Oh, gosh.
Now, here's the deal. That's what Fezzi's going through for no fucking apparent reason with his diabetic nerve problems.
Yeah, just having nerve pain for.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I know, like, just from that one punch, I felt like, I don't think my arm is ever going to move again. And it took years before I told him that story. I just kept it from him because I'm an asshole. I couldn't say.
You didn't give him his due.
Yeah, you punched me so hard, the nerve in my arm fucking locked my arm up. Jerk off. Yeah, that nerve damage, no good, huh? Not a good thing. Andrew, what's up?
Hey, Ronnie B. I don't know if it was the same night, but when you had a Sweet Melissa do like a fake orgasm contest, and I don't know what the hell she was saying, but they dumped out of like 2 or 3 minutes of the show.
Oh, yeah. They had to. There was a thing in Florida, because we put out a thing where a girl, she was on someone's shoulder, and everybody was chanting to her. And she got overly excited, and I'll just say excited herself right there because I don't want to go into it. Because later, because we put that in the video, she sued us, and we had to pay her some money out.
Really?
Yeah, because she had found Jesus.
And she found Jesus, and Jesus said, you need to sue the shit out of these people.
Yeah, I guess that's what she did. I guess that's how it worked out. A lot of people want this poster. Artie Lang has already retweeted it. Go over to the iBank. It's once in a kind of a lifetime shot to get a poster signed by Judd Apatow, Artie Lang, Pete Holmes, signed poster. And this show is very, very funny.
It's so funny. And it was so great to have all three of them together. Like, you know, an Unmasked with any one of those people. Fantastic, but all three of them, it really was great, and there's some really, really awesome stories that they tell.
Well, particularly Artie, who can tell a story off the top of his head anywhere. But I'll just tell you this, in this show, Artie plays this character, Artie Lang. And, you know, a middle-aged guy who you'll just see get in trouble with something and run as fast as he can down the street. And then when someone else catches up to him, he's eating like a slice of pizza. And where were you, dude? He's able to shake it off again. And it's such like a weird New York thing that you could find yourself in this, you know, where someone's trying to mug you or something. And then 5 minutes later, you're just like, yeah, put it behind us, you know. You hungry?
You have to.
So that's coming up at 2 o'clock, but you can go over and pick that up at the iBang. They talk about, and this is one of my favorite things ever, just stories that are like disaster moments, you know? Like just, because it's kind of what the show is about. Like here, Pete Holmes is just getting started. He goes up on stage, and it takes a while before you can be funny on stage. Even if you have a couple jokes, there's still nights that you just eat it. There's nights now when guys have been doing comedy for decades.
Yeah.
Eat it. It's just part of the process.
And then it's weird because it's like these are people who are naturally funny.
You would hope anyone who went on stage was naturally funny. I think now, because of the internet, there are comedy nerds who are just like trying to learn the mathematics of being funny. But if you look at Artie Lang, there's an unconscious funniness there. I mean, the story about when he, you know, stabbed himself. How should that be a funny fucking story? And it is. Mm-hmm. When he tells it, it's fucking hilarious. He wears this cap whenever he goes out now, you know? It's just this, you know, winter cap. And it looks like he spent no time putting it together. You know what I mean? Like how to make it look okay on his head. And then he says to, I think it was Seth Meyers they did, I'm wearing this cap because, you know, I got a bald spot and I'm kind of got an ego about it. And you're just like, could you come up with something better than that? And I watch him on stage. He'll be talking. And he'll just pull that cap off and all of his hair goes up in the air with it. Fucking, he's not trying to be funny. And it's the funniest shit ever. And any story that he tells is just hilarious. He's got a million fucking hilarious stories. I love Artie. I think he's just a blast. All right, so that's coming up next, Chris.
Coming up next.
Go over to the iBang right now and try to win this poster. You just sign up and your chance to win the poster. Send that unmasked around to your friends or people in the know. So we'll head on into that. Enjoy it.
It's a great one.
Yeah. This is Bennington. I like the extra pop for Artie. Like, they didn't know whether he was going to be here or not.
I can't believe he made it.
Yeah.
I've lost Artie in between press things.
Yeah.
Like, we'll do radio in the morning, and then we have a talk show, and Artie just doesn't make it.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Then you did make it.
I had a dime bag hidden in the mail. 5 years ago, I had something. Somebody took it.
Guilty.
Last time, thank God, it was for muffins. I literally said, Artie, how did we lose you between point A and point B? And he goes, I see muffins better than you do.
In my own car, I got a muffin.
Is that some slang we've never heard before, Artie?
No.
We're copping muffins.
No, this is an actual muffin.
Well, Crashing is the new TV show. And I was telling you guys right before it started, I've been telling Artie since December, I don't think you've watched it yet. The show's incredible.
Oh,
and it's
you.
Just an amazing look at stand-up comedy like we've never seen before.
I'm so happy to hear that. We were talking a little bit off mic, and I think Judd and I were excited because it's an opportunity to show someone who's bad at comedy. Like, everybody's bad for like a decade, wouldn't you say, Art? It takes a really long time for stand-ups just to get like pretty good. That's like 5 years. And then to be like really good, 10 years, I would say. And most shows that I've seen about stand-up start when they've been doing it 10 years. They're already hilarious. And I love a lot of those shows. But I like the origin story. I want to know the pain and the suffering and the odd jobs and all the strange things you have to do to scrap together a living. And of course, on our show, my character has so little money that he has to stay with other comedians like Artie. So I pick up like strange advice, some that's good, some that might not be so good. We like to call Artie he's like the ghost of Christmas future, like warning me. Like, are you sure? He has this great line in the pilot. He's like, it's not just this, being on stage is only an hour a night. There's a lot of time to fill and there's a lot of choices to make. So he tries to save my kind of doughy-eyed youth pastor-looking character.
well, there you go. Oh, my God.
Yeah, are we done?
It's all there.
We're out of here.
But, Judd, is there another art form that somebody could be new and then literally hanging around with the people? It's almost like a guy who is in single-A baseball is taking batting practice with Jeter.
That's
you
right.
know, and it happens.
Well, that's the fun part of comedy is you can hang out with the people who are good as you're learning if you're not too annoying.
That's right.
And that's the key. Like, if you're not annoying,
yeah.
part of the game is shut up and sit next to Bill Burr.
I mean, that's what I was always trying to do. We would work at the Improv in, like, 1986, and I'd be there with, like, Sandler, and we just wanted to sit at Bud Freeman's table, and we knew Seinfeld might sit down, or Paul Reiser, or people like that, and it was the most exciting thing in the world, and you were afraid to make a joke.
Right.
You were afraid. It was too much to risk the whole thing. One bad joke, and you were not going to be asked back.
Young stand-ups are like Spider from Goodfellas.
Exactly.
That's exactly right.
Yeah.
Thank you. I was just handed a five-hour energy drink, by the way. I was up early hosting the Today Show, so get out of me.
It's like going to McDonald's for a salad. It's like going to your Coke dealer for a five-hour energy drink.
You know, one of the things that Pete, the character, does, I thought early on, the first joke is a funny joke, but the audience doesn't trust him yet, which is huge.
You're really telegraphing, like a nervous stand-up comedian can tell a good joke, but the audiences, I've been in audiences where I'm so nervous for the comedian that you can't enjoy it.
Right.
It's like you're trying to land a plane, but you're like shaking. Nobody likes that.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? You have to have confidence. So a lot of the jokes that we did were technically okay or good jokes. I actually got to retell a lot of the jokes that I wrote in my first couple of years of stand-up. Some of them were okay, but what we...
No, they weren't.
And then, well, that's true. They're not great because we want to show that the struggle's real. What's happening?
There's a giant video screen here, and suddenly I saw me interviewing Mel Brooks, and I got excited.
That's happening right now. I don't know how we're doing it.
In another dimension.
No, that's Bruno Mars. I love it. He's telling a story. I'd rather hear about him interviewing Mel Brooks.
Well, you know, when we were talking about getting good at comedy, a lot of times it's just that you're acting the way you are around your friends before you start a stand-up.
That's absolutely right.
It's such a difference, funny-wise, it's like on or off stage. You talk about great jokes. You know that idea of, like, if you walk... The first time I ever got the guts to walk into the Comedy Cellar when I was younger... the first comic I saw was Dave Attell, which is a bad thing.
Right.
Yeah. Because, you know, it's like that old thing where somebody, I think Clapton saw Jimi Hendrix or something, like, I just cried. You know? The first joke I heard Dave Attell say, and I say it to myself, this guy better not be, like, you know, an average comic. You know? This is going to be so dated. It involves cassettes and a record store. All right. He said, John Denver. There's a guy who missed the boat musically. You know, I was at Sam Goody the other day. A John Denver cassette cost 99 cents. A blank cassette cost $2.50. All right. Now, John Denver could triple his money if he'd shut the fuck up.
Wow. Right,
that's the first joke I hear. I went up to one of the bouncers, and I said, this guy is considered, like, really good, right? It can be, it's so intimidating.
Yeah.
One of the ways we would bomb is because not just me, but other characters have to struggle in the show. Jed would do this brilliant but somewhat brutal thing where, let's say you guys are the audience on the TV show. We wouldn't tell you anything. I'd go up, do my set. You guys might laugh. And then Jed would just be like, do it again. And you do it again, and you guys are like, what the fuck is going on? And then you do it again.
Yeah.
So the third time, not that cassette joke, that was a masterpiece, yeah. But most yeah, like, jokes, three times, right. It doesn't matter how good they are, you hate it. And that's how we would get that. Like, I would really get the biological response of bombing. You'd get the lower back sweat, you get the dry mouth. So Judd would trick me into being a better actor.
But Pete was always bad because every once in a while he would do one of his killer jokes, and it would bomb. It would bomb.
There's this instinct you have. Yeah. It never goes away. You're bombing. It's 300 extras, and you're just like, all right, I got to get these guys back. And then you're like, oh, daddy's going to show you the big guns, and it still bombs. And you're like, oh, comedy is always death.
You realize it's your show, and you go, I could just tell the director to tell them. But
that is true. Yeah. There was other scenes when we were doing stand-up, and it was a fantasy. I was like, I told a joke. I'd be like, you ever hail a cab just to stop it from hitting you? And then they wouldn't laugh like that, and I'd go, we need a bigger laugh for that. We need a bigger laugh. And then we'd do it again, and they would. They'd be like, ah, my dad.
Johnny Carson.
That happened when we did Funny People. Aubrey Plaza was doing stand-up, and she was bombing, but the whole crowd was extras, and she really started freaking out, and I just had to yell out, this is not real.
Well, you know, sometimes you think you're in it so long, you're beyond bombing, and then you bomb. Mm-hmm. And I say, wow, you know. But repeating a joke, the craziest thing, Pittsburgh Funny Bone. When I do the Midwest, I'm always the thinnest person in the room, including a lot of the women. And a guy in the front row, about a 400-pound guy with a Pittsburgh Steelers shirt on, knee-high white socks and orthopedic sneakers, and he's sitting there like mad. He didn't make an emotion. Even jokes are killing. He was like, and he lost a bet or something. And I was very drunk on stage, no. And I repeated a joke, okay, and he went, did it! I said, thank you, sir.
Yeah.
10 minutes later, I repeated the same joke. Did it! But the greatest thing happened. This is like a comic when you know something's going to kill and you could turn on this asshole. I see a woman making her way to the empty seat that's been next to this guy. It's clearly his wife, you know, or his brother. And she sits down, and I knew what I was going to say. I couldn't wait. It was like, you know, heroin. Well, for me, heroin's like heroin. But she sits down, and I go, and who is this? And he goes, it's my wife. And I went, dinner! It's the hardest laugh I've gotten in show business.
I hate those elegant heckles. The worst heckle I ever got was,
to the point.
Was one word. It was, next! You can't come back from next.
I opened for Norman Vegas, and one woman said, not funny, to a joke. And he went, you can, by not laughing, I get the message. You don't have to say not funny.
Yeah.
But you know, that's like Esty, who books the Comedy Cellar. She plays the heckler.
It's amazing.
In the pilot.
Perfect casting.
And her heckle is, write some jokes.
Which is like kind of accurate. Like she has a knowledge of the scene. Like, workshop this at open mics. Yeah. Then come to the clubs.
Esty can be cold. She's, I've been going there for 20 years almost, and she's sometimes, And
are you going to tell the family?
Well, no, Louis C.K. got famous. But I've known Louis for 12 like friends. And Esty's talking to me. I'm at the table, and she's the front door is over my shoulder, and she's going, Artie, you are like family. You're like family here. You're like on the Mount Rushmore. I love you so much. Give me a hug. And she sees Louis coming over. She goes, get up! What are you talking? I thought like, you know, Elvis came. I know Louis. Yeah. What about the guy from Girl Code? Can he get up? He likes to sit there and create. I said, this is a fucking joke.
Right. how much money do you think they've made, though, because Louis did
$4 billion.
That theme, and having people walk in, and now people do that every day.
That pizza place made $1 billion.
Yeah, that
too.
Pizza place. But you go down there, it's like the Rocky Steps in Philly. Yeah. People just
want
to do
that.
Yeah, it's much easier.
But I still get out of breath. I hold my gun. Yes. My gun.
We just went to Philly. The statue of Rocky is at the bottom of the steps. Who fucked up?
Yeah. Well, the museum doesn't consider it art. right? It's, they're like, do you want to see this
the
statue?
Rocky statue?
Yeah, they're like, it's a piece of shit statue. But more, because the people run up the steps, but they don't go in the museum.
Oh, I see. Put it in the museum?
Yeah. I didn't even know it was a museum. I thought that was a gym.
So did Stallone.
Very nice gym.
You know, we're talking about like rough clubs. There's a club in Philly. It's a black club that everybody plays. And the crowd is so like knowledgeable that they'll get up and light the person. They just walk into the back and hit the light.
That is the new best heckle. No words. Just hold up a cell phone. That's the signal for the comedian to get off and be like, is that real?
Yeah. I thought the best advice for a young comedian ever happens in the show, and it's Greer Barnes. And he just says, quit. Don't do this.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
And that's a sane thing to say to somebody.
I hate to say it because it's a bit of a cliche, but it is one of those, if you can do anything else, you should do that.
Right.
Because it really is it's a compulsion. Like, look at Jed. Jed has no reason to be risking his career doing stand-up again. But he loves it. You know what I mean? He made it, but he wants to go back. He told me, he was like, it's the movies and the shows, but I love being on stage at Gotham. I'm like, it's in your blood. I know that's a cliche, but it really
is
true.
I want you to lower my self-esteem and my salary at the same time.
It is a rough thing to go back to, man.
It was, you know why? Because when I was a kid, I had nothing to talk about. I did it from the time I was 17 till I was 24. So to go back to it in my late 40s when I actually have stories and things to say,
and a daughter.
It's actually much easier. Daughter. And I feel like I developed a voice by not doing it. Just from being out in the world and doing talk shows and things like that.
That's actually one of the things we're addressing on the show, is that when you're starting out as a stand-up, and I was really like 20, 21 or whatever, but my character on Crashing is pretty much starting out, and you don't have anything to talk about. Mm. Yeah. You're going up. That's why my bits back then and on this show are about like road signs and just kind of like, I remember an old joke of mine, this is to give you an idea of how bad I was. It was like, I was looking on the back of a ice pack and it said, a bittering agent has been added to discourage consumption. I was like, I love that. This is how Seinfeldy I was. I was like, I love that because apparently before the ice packs were too delicious, right? That's such a stupid joke. I appreciate that you like it, but because I do the Seinfeld voice, everything works in the Seinfeld voice. But you do that until Judd had a life and I had a divorce, and you start going through some pain and you start realizing, this is going to be very kind of cliche, but you realize, oh, shit happens that you need to talk about, that you need to process in front of people that they can relate to. And when you laugh at it, you have perspective. So suddenly you feel like you're fighting for something and you become funnier. And I wouldn't have been nearly as funny if my wife hadn't left me. How strange is that?
First career break you had.
Exactly. It was a breakup.
It was always in you. Absolutely. Yeah. I think so. I think you're funny. The one exception to that might be Dave Chappelle, because when he came to town, he was 19 years old. And he had a cigarette. He seemed like Miles Davis, like a jazz musician, like experienced life. And he had such perspective on stuff, and he was hilarious. And he could give advice to older people. I remember one time he watched me do a set. He went, you need something in your hand. I go, what do you mean? He goes, you need to smoke a cigarette. You look awkward up there. I'm like, all right. All right, teenager.
Murphy was that way too. When Eddie Murphy came on as a kid,
Were impressions. I know like what Judge told me. Like, I think the greatest single set of stand up comedy, I'm not saying anything surprising to a lot of people, is that first Richard Pryor film. He is like, it's like the, like what Paul Newman says in The Hustler about shooting pool with the pool cue. The mic is like part of his arm. Like, he was born with it. He's so smooth up there, the physical stuff and the characters. And he does that when he's 40. Because he had lived life, and he was this hilarious guy, just genius, grew up in a whorehouse, but now he had divorces and, you know, shooting his wife's car on cocaine.
Yeah.
And he just told those stories. It was so amazing.
Well, that's kind of one of the things we're exploring on the show as well. Artie says to me, we get in a scuffle, and I get like cut with a knife, and he goes, good. You're a man now. You're I got stabbed funny. Yeah. Right. And Artie's like, I stabbed myself funny. Yeah. You know what I mean? Like, I'm not trying to be funny. That's something he said.
Apparently I wasn't funny enough.
But what is going on there? Richard Pryor is, I was raised in a whorehouse funny. Yeah. But there's something beautiful and kind of, and very much redemptive of taking these painful things and turning them into something that we can laugh at. That's why I tease Artie.
Well, Artie in the first episode is running away from danger two different times.
Right.
And that
as you run towards it.
Yeah. But that is that funny thing. Like, you could tell this is not the first time Artie ran from trouble. Yeah. Yeah,
yeah. John made me do it a few times. So,
the last could have time, lost them.
Yeah. Yeah. Again, the whole experience was unbelievable. How casual it was, you know. Judd, it was like some guy I went to high school with or something, this powerful guy who was believing in me, and you want to do good for someone. But by the fifth time, I'm like, I don't know if I could do this anymore. But having a heart attack would have been funny.
Yeah.
Well, having a heart attack's funny.
Well, it doesn't kill you, only makes you funnier. Exactly. I joke with Artie, though. You know, he makes fun of himself and all this stuff. But on the set, he was the guy. We had a lot of other actors that were far less prepared and less professional than Artie. I was like, your next book should be called Consummate Professional. It was just not what you would expect. He's a phenomenal actor. I love telling the story because I think it's a big part of why the pilot got picked up, and it involves Judd and Artie. We're doing this scene where Pete tells Artie that my wife left me and all this stuff, and I need a place to stay. And he's like, fuck no, you can't stay with me, but I'll buy you a piece of pizza. And we had this like scene written out, and it was written out, you know, not sitcom style, but it was punchy. It was like, I say this, he says this, and then wah, 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 you know. And we had that in case we needed it. And then Judd just goes, Artie, tell Pete what you would tell a new comedian. And we're shooting on films, and the reason I mention that is because the reels last 15 minutes. Yeah. And Artie just went for the entire 15 minutes. Never braked. I'm just reacting, which is a dream, because, you know, he's being hilarious. I know, right? I just get to relax and just listen to this master. And at the end of the reel, everyone applauds, like Nick Nolte doing a monologue. It was incredible. So to have Artie not acting for, I think it's 14 years.
Well, yeah, sort of.
It's insane.
Well, it was Elf. Yeah, you, I improvised with another guy like Will Ferrell in that one.
You do smell like beef and cheese. That is true.
I want to find that kid who's on my knee in that scene. He's probably about 20 years old because he heard a lot of crazy shit.
See how it affected him.
Yeah,
exactly.
But we're sitting around talking about how long it takes to be funny on stage. I always have the feeling that if Artie never went near a stage, he'd be this funny.
Yeah,
you know
yeah.
what I mean? Like, there's some guys that just have a home run swing.
I know.
You know, yeah. and Artie's no, one of those guys.
He is those guys strike out a lot. Too.
Yeah.
He's like Babe Ruth, and I don't mean that just because he's big up top with the little legs.
But having Judd Apatow edit it, too, it's great to, like, know that this guy, you could trust him to do it. You know, he's not going to let anything by. It was just the most enjoyable thing. Like, that was so relaxing to me. That's why I was able to do that.
Well,
and I actually came from being unprepared because I didn't know the script. But everything was that much fun to me on the script.
But Judd will do that. I mean, that's a big reason why I think people love his movies and the TV shows love and all these great things is because you have the script and you always know you can do it. But once you know you can do it, sometimes we never got to it because you just do something way funnier and everybody seems like a better actor when you're just trying to be in that moment.
Well, also I think what comes through is that Judd has an appreciation of comedy first. And you look at the people in this, it's Artie, it's TJ Miller, it's Sarah Silverman. These people are in the same universe. If this was music, that would be like a jazz musician, a rock musician, but everybody comes together.
That's right.
In comedy.
It's like a species.
Yeah.
It really is. Sometimes people ask me, they ask me if I believe the premise of the show. Would comedians let someone who was kicked out of their, not kicked out, but they leave because their wife is fucking somebody. So you leave and you don't have anywhere to stay. And they're like, do you believe the conceit of the show that comedians would take them in? And I'm like, yes, that's what happened. TJ Miller was shooting a movie right when my wife left me. He flew me out to Pittsburgh, put me in his hotel, and we hung out for a week. And then Nick Kroll was like the first person that helped me find an apartment. And John Mulaney got me in an office that had a couch that I could sleep on. All these like real things happen. So it was a pleasure to recreate them in the show. And in some cases with the actual people, and in some cases having them say the same advice they gave me in real life, but we're filming it. It's like if Black Mirror was happy, that's what,
yeah,
it was like Happy Mirror. I guess that would just be Funhouse Mirror. It was the most surreal thing, but it gives you perspective on the whole thing. It was a very healing process, but at the end of the day, it was also just very funny. Because with comedians, you buy, no matter the situation, your wife's leaving you, or you're sad, or you're depressed, or you're in a tough spot, we're always making jokes. So it's like, you watch Friends, you're like, why are these guys are fucking hilarious, they should all be comedians, but this guy's an anthropologist or something. Right. But on our show, we're always making jokes because it's a believable world, and because that's how we are.
One of my favorite foreshadows of the whole thing is like, your wife is telling you, don't make this into a bit, stop bit, you know?
Yeah.
And then later on, you're staying at TJ's house where he wakes up in the morning on and you bits. Get it. You're like, oh, fuck.
Yeah.
You know, enough.
But that's what it is. You start to go, am I ready to change into a werewolf? And will I? Pete, my character is religious and sweet. And the thing that we think gives the show some stakes is how much of his soul is he going to hold on to? Like, it's really interesting that these people are there, but he's going to have to make choices about sex and drugs, and how's he going to behave in kind of a world full of werewolves?
Mm-hmm.
It's going to be interesting to see. Yeah. On Sunday, February 19th, on HBO After Girls. We're calling it the Avatar.
We're also on the road right now.
Yes, February
20th. Another fun time. February 18th in L.A. at the Regent, and on the 22nd at the Herbst Theater in San Francisco, and you can get tickets at PeteHolmes.com, and all the money goes to charity.
100%.
Goes to 826 in San Francisco, and in L.A., it goes to 826 in L.A., and also...
USO?
No, that was in New York, but Vals Charity.
Vals Charity, oh, Real Girl, which is a female empowerment program for girls between like 9 and 14 when their self-esteem plummets. Mm-hmm. They do some really cool things where they like, with fashion magazines, and they write like, get real, you're fucking fake, which is really important so they don't, you know.
So you've done some of these shows already, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, we've
had a great crowd at the last night at the Gramercy Theater, sold out.
Well, you know? Artie, I saw you putting this together at the stand, and you were concerned if your humor was going to work in front of these guys' audience.
Well, last night, again, when I saw what they looked like afterwards, which were very conservative looking. They were so great. They had a sense of humor. You know, they had I said some harsh shit.
Well, it was funny because we're in Philly and I'm like nervous because we're performing for Artie's crowd. It felt like. So we're both getting tastes of different crowds.
Oh, you destroyed there. Yeah, they loved you.
Well, it was great. And my crowd loved you. Mine, there were just more V-neck sweaters.
I couldn't believe how conservative that meat grill was.
Yeah.
One fan of mine, she wanted to jump on my back, if you remember that. Ossified drunk.
Yeah.
On crystal meth.
Yeah, and, that was an Artie. She didn't even say hello to me. my fans have a very churchy vibe. And I was saying to Jed, I've worked very hard to, like, comedy is so rough and tumble. And I'm like, I just want to have a fun, sweet time. And now I found an audience, which I'm glad. But then occasionally you still have to go back to Philly and see if you can duke it out.
Yeah, that happens with everybody, no matter who
Absolutely.
It is.
Well, it's silly. You're going to think I'm kidding, but it's a great Sinbad quote where he goes, comedians are funnier when they're riding the bus. Because if you start just performing for your fans and riding in private cars and all this stuff, you lose touch. And that's what I think maybe, you tell me, Judd, is appealing. Stand-up really is a meritocracy. Judd Apatow goes on stage, and this is a Seinfeld thing, for the first minute and a half, there's a grace period. Because they're like, oh, I really like Knocked Up. And then at 1 minute 31 seconds, they're like, make with the jokes, Apatow.
Yeah.
And then it's harder than it is for the other people, I think, you know, we've got to live up to that.
It fades fast.
Absolutely.
But I think if you're doing a good job, it helps because I feel like the audience feels like they know me from watching all the movies and watching what I talk about. And so it feels richer because they are already... You know,
when you say my wife, they know about. It's Leslie, and they know your daughter's from the from This Is 40.
Yeah.
Watching Judd do a stand-up is actually very entertaining because you really seem like it's cathartic for you. He gets very loud. It's hilarious. He becomes Kinnison for a little while.
Yeah,
and it's real funny, you know.
As a husband, he doesn't want to sneak out and have an affair. He wants to sneak out and do three sets. <of the cellar. laughs>
That's a good man.
That is a good man. I wish my wife had done that. JK, hope she's happy.
So that whole
no matter,
I wish you the best.
No matter how tough it is, like you say, working with some comics who might be rooting against you in life, at least they always say stuff that's funny, even in negative situations. My favorite story is the movie Dirty Work with me and Norm Macdonald. My hometown paper said, and the review said, Artie Lang has all the charm of a date rapist. Here's how Norm cheered me up. Hey, man, that's fucking great. A date rapist has to have way more charm than a regular rapist.
Silver lining, right? Yeah.
That's kind. See?
Thanks, buddy.
Yeah.
We're good to each other.
I feel great now.
Well, Pete, that whole backstory, this is all true. Everything that
It's based on true events. Yeah, we just made it a lot funnier. Mm-hmm. That's Jed's specialty. When I pitched him the show, he had me write a lot about what really happened, and then he's like, okay, let's fix this. We can't just have it be like a real divorce. It's a lot of quiet weeping and ice cream and vodka and all that sort of stuff. And a show, you know, we have a yard sale, we have a car crash, we have all these events that happen because that's what it feels like. You know, it's the emotion is true, but the events are way funnier and way more eventful. To swing from guest star to guest star to guest star, that's a pretty cool life. So it's way funnier, and that's what he does. He's like, okay, that's what it felt like. This is what it looks like.
Were you that naive as a young person, though?
I was, yeah.
Yeah.
I worked at the Boston Comedy Club, and I handed out flyers on McDougal and Third, which is so we shot an episode about that. It's called Barking, and the act of handing out flyers. And we shot it on McDougal and Third, which was amazing to do that actual corner. People thought I was on drugs. Like they asked me if I was on ecstasy or something, because every day I was just like, we're doing a set in Manhattan, you guys. This is amazing. Like,
what's the matter, you jerk off?
Yeah. Club manager has coke on the side of his face. He's like, what the fuck? Yeah. I'm high and I'm not as happy as you are. I was just so pleased. A funny thing happened when we were on that corner. We were filming, and I was feeling kind of proud of myself that we had taken over a part of the village, and there was a big crane shooting a light, and I was like, this is really a dream come true. And this homeless woman, or an insane woman, I don't know if she has an apartment. You never know in New York, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Rent control. She's like, it's 3 ketchup packets a month or whatever. I thought that was funnier than you gave it. She came up to me. She came up to me and she goes, are you the movie star? And again, like I was feeling it. I was feeling really happy. And I was like, well, it's not technically a movie, but I'll give her a thrill. And I was like, yes, indeed, ma'am. I am the movie star. And then she made a claw with her right hand and grammed it into my balls and grabbed them like a talon, and she went, I did it! I did it! Like a bet she made with invisible friends. And then the director comes running over, I'm assuming to help me. I don't even move, because I'm an actor. I'm acting in this. I'm so used to people touching my clothes and giving me makeup. I'm just like, well, this is happening. And it's like a bear trap. If you struggle, it just gets worse. The director comes running over, I'm assuming to tell her to get away from the talent, and he gives her $20. You know, so we shot in New York, and New York things really happen. Yeah.
But the good thing about New York is that was Liza Minnelli.
If I tell that story again, can I have that punchline?
Go right ahead.
This is how we are.
You got
are
an extra 20?
What's that?
Extra 20 for Artie?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, I'll throw you 20 for that one.
I'll take it.
That's worth 20.
I'll take it.
Judd, you did the kind of same thing, but in L.A., right, when you were younger. You went to L.A. first or New York first?
On Long Island. I did East Side Comedy Club on Long Island, and then Governors and Chuckles and all of those places. And then I went to...
Chuckles is a very not ambitious name for a comedy club. Like, you'll be mildly amused. Not hilarities.
That guy on the Coke called Sucks.
Sorry.
Then I went to USC for a year, and I was doing stand-up there, but I couldn't really get spots anywhere, so Sammy Shore, who started the Comedy Store, started a comedy club in a fish house in Marina Del Rey. Sammy's by the shore, and he would let me book it. And in return, I could go on stage, and so I for about
Holy
a year.
Father, right?
Yeah. So who just had his 90th birthday? Happy birthday, Sammy! And I was able to book
Happy
that
birthday. Yeah. That was a Pauly Shore impression, and I'm glad it didn't work.
Yeah.
I'm being honest. Let it go.
But then it was just, can you get in the improv with Bud? I mean, everything was right. When do you go in front of Bud? And it was terrifying because you knew if you didn't do well in front of Bud, you'd have to wait a while to do it again. And Sandler moved to L.A. because Bud saw him in New York and said, if you move out, I'll really take care of you. And so he was always there. And then finally I got in. I would host 5 or 6 nights a week. Mm-hmm. And so I would see everybody and get to meet everyone, which is what was most exciting, because I'd bring on, you know, Leno and Seinfeld and Ellen and all the people that were there every night back then.
I never really told you this yet, because if you notice, I bring up funny people to you a lot, because when I saw it in the theater, I liked it, but then, like, it's one of those things where it's become maybe my favorite movie about a guy like that about comedy too, because on a way lower level I relate to it. And that opening scene, I was always fascinated. One of the first questions I asked you when I got to know you, that opening scene in Funny People, what point in your lives is mm-hmm. that? It's you and Adam Sandler and Ben Stiller. It's like the future of American comedy. It's so rare that two roommates become that successful. You know, it's mm-hmm. like usually one guy is not, but you two like took over the world.
It was a weird moment. Also, Janine Garofalo's in that shot. Also, she Doug Benson was in that room as well.
Oh, really?
But so
which one? Who was also in that?
Doug Benson was also there. Right, yeah. And what happened was that Adam, you know, his career hadn't really gotten going yet. He was on MTV a little bit, but he had so much comedy energy that all day long he was so funny with us. You know, now he had nowhere to put it, so he would just make us laugh like crazy all day long, and he would make phony phone calls all the time. And I came home one night and he was doing them alone. He was alone. And he would call up comedy clubs and complain about the comics. You know? And so he would call up and go, I went into the club tonight and Charles Fleischer said my wife farted. My wife did not fart, and I did not come to a comedy club to be told my wife farted. And
can you imagine if he did that now? You'd hang up and be like, I think I just got pregnant by Adam Sandler.
Yeah, no one knew any of the voices. And so I started audio recording them because I felt bad as a hoarder that they would disappear and never be heard again. It'd be like, it hurt me that they were so funny. And
well,
then
that started you interviewing the people as a teenager too. Yes. When you came into Howard the first time, not my last day, you had the tape with him. It's amazing.
That's right. I interviewed Howard, and he only gave me 8 minutes. And
you were 16 or something, right?
Yes. Yeah. So we played it, and so I started videotaping them just because I knew they were gold. And I'm such a hoarder. And when we were making the movie, I thought, I wonder if those videotapes exist. And my wife is always upset with me for hoarding because I just, you know, I'm a man with money who hoards, so they're in very nice storage spaces. But they're bottles of urine. They're still bottles of urine.
Most hoarders keep a Burger King a box full of urine.
Yeah, exactly. And then I had it, and I just happened to have all these tapes of him.
Hoarder is such a negative term. You're an everything enthusiast.
Exactly. I love it all.
That's not what they look like on that show.
Yeah. I always watch that show and then try to, you know, I root on the hoarders not to throw stuff out. And it's like, you need that Newsweek.
You never know. No, like 600 Pound Life. I watched that to feel, I feel like such a winner. I'm leading my 280 pound life.
Yeah, yeah. You're at the end of that show. Like, if you were on that show, that's the end.
Right? That's the operation we're not going to allow to.
Everybody say he looks great.
Yeah, yeah.
You worked with Shandling, obviously, when you were younger, and you're doing a documentary.
Yes, I'm doing a documentary for HBO about Gary Shandling, so I've been interviewing everybody from his world the last few months. And so we were talking to Kevin Nealon and Sarah Silverman and Conan and Jay Leno and David Duchovny. Hopefully that'll be on, I don't know if it'll be on at the end of this year or the beginning of next year, but it's an amazing story because he started writing comedy for Welcome Back Kotter and Sanford and Son, and then did stand up at the Comedy Store in the 70s when every night it was Richard Pryor and Robin Williams were there, and then created all these shows and just had this remarkable
people
life.
People bring up the show.
He wrote for Sanford and Son. You know, that there's such a funny Red Fox story where supposedly somebody, an agent of his who was black said, you know, you got no brothers in the writer's room, man. Come on. So, you know, and he said, yeah, you're right. Fire on the Jews in the writer's room. I want brothers in there. So the first read through with the network with the black writers, it bombed. And Red Fox got up and said, bring me back my Jews.
Fighting first.
And Shandling was one of them.
Shandling wrote a camping trip episode.
That's great.
So him and who is his son?
Whose son?
What was his
Orange
son?
The dummy? Desmond Wilson? You mean that? In the show. Yeah, the dummy. Yeah.
Yeah.
Damon Wilson.
But, you know, everyone gives Shandling a lot because of the two breakthrough TV shows.
Yes.
But his stand-up.
That's
was
remarkable.
Amazing. And I remember the first time I saw Shandling on TV, and I'm just like, this is unbelievable.
I mean, he had perfect jokes. He had this one joke we always laugh at, which is, I like to shave one leg, so I feel like I'm sleeping with a woman.
But then you have all his old notebooks, and yeah. I've had the privilege of being with Judd when he's looking through Gary's notebooks, and you'll just see written in the margin, like, what do cats dream about? What's a cat nightmare? Quicksand in the litter box? Just like little things that you're like, that would have been a great tweet.
He was also the fastest, from what I saw, the fastest guy, like back witty, you know. From what I saw, I never hung out with him.
Well, he was very into Buddhism and, you know, things like Zen and the art of archery, and his whole thing was to be present and in the moment and trust that your comedy will come if you're completely present and not thinking. And there's a lot of things in these journals he has that are about that, about, okay, you're about to do the Tonight Show with Johnny Carson. You know what to do. So if you don't think at all, if you'll just be funny. And that was an interesting approach to it that really worked for him. He always looked so comfortable.
That's amazing that people go, like, when I do a talk show, I'm like, do I have socks on? that he was that meticulous is amazing to me. You know?
We did a morning talk show in Philly with Artie, and he rolls in a little bit late, and we're sitting there, and the anchor's talking about how he got in trouble for saying something, or someone else on the show got in trouble for saying something in front of some kids. Yeah. So he had apologized. And then this is on like 8 a.m. in Philly. And then the anchor's like, all right, I'm going to come. And then Artie goes, is that what you said to the kids? It was like 8 a.m. Everyone has those phony, bad LSD trip smiles. And they're just like, we'll be right back with more from Artie Lang.
And that guy was going into the DTs.
Oh, yeah, for sure.
But Artie, is that an impulse for you to do that kind of stuff? Because obviously, you know, there's a couple of famous cases with you. You stopped an HBO talk show after two episodes.
No, I saved an HBO talk show. Nobody was doing anything. Chad Ochocinco was boring. Brett Favre was boring. And it was live. And the producer said, look, go at Joe. You're the guys of the comedians. And Jason Sudeikis was there at the time. I did not know who he was. He was with January Jones. Apparently, he's this generation's Warren Beatty, apparently. And Paul Rudd. And he's such a nice guy, but him and Joe have a thing where they grew up together, so it was kind of an inside joke they were making. The audience didn't get. So I think Joe panicked that little riff didn't do well, and he went to me. The last thing Joe said was, Art, you've been on TMZ, that's my favorite website. And again, I'm not the most brilliant comic, and I'm from New Jersey, so I made this joke. I said, TMZ is your favorite website. What's your second favorite website? Cocksucker.com. Okay.
I like that you blame the state of New Jersey on that one.
I looked over, his kids were there.
How old were the children?
Like 12 and 10.
Yeah.
Michael Irvin was guffawing. So it got a huge laugh into an applause break. And that was, you know, gas for me. So I kept going. And the next 10 minutes were the most awkward minutes in the history of television. I skewered him.
Yes.
And gave a new website for his children to look at.
I really went at him. But, okay, the first five got laughs. Then it got awkward. And I kept doing it. And then I became not funny. It stopped. Paul Rudd, I swear to God, if he doesn't say this is the truth, I'll be mad, because he leaned over to me and made me feel so good. He goes, what you just did is legendary.
Yeah.
I go, everything's great. This is fantastic. Then we went on the internet, and that 15 minutes on the internet after the TV show, I was one of the most disgusting people you'll ever see on the planet. I was terrible to him. Obnoxious. And I got no laughs. I left on my high horse, everything's great. I go to Howard the next morning. He's giggling. Bad sign. He goes, have you seen the New York Post? No. It's about you and Joe Buck. I'm like, I was going to say Artie saves the show. And I go, I said, do you think, Howard said, do you think that? I said, yeah. He goes, let's do it on the air. Big headline, Artie Lang banned from HBO. He's an ogre. He's a scumbag.
And, I said, no one ever said you were banned from HBO when we asked you to do this.
What happened was it lasted a day because they wanted ratings, and Joe called me up and asked me to come back for the second episode.
Second and last, wasn't it? The last episode?
No, they did four of them.
They did four?
Which I predicted on them. I said, you do about four of these tops.
Wow.
I had my hand on the pulse of HBO. But Joe was never mad at me. HBO was very mad at me.
You know, but this is the strange thing about comedy, too, right? I mean, this is kind of the show. Something very uncomfortable happens, and then that is right. comedy. You know,
he's not telling the story about the time he went on a talk show and he was charming and eloquent.
Exactly.
He's telling a story about a disaster. And those happen.
Yeah.
We cram them together so they happen a little bit closer to one another because it's a half-hour show. But those are the stories you tell. And those are the stories. They're your war stories. If you go sit at the table at the Cellar now, nobody wants to hear about the corporate gig you did where you weren't doing it in front of a working elevator. Mm-hmm. They want to know about, like, the
worst
situation.
And you found that
situation.
Out by telling that story. That table absolutely is very harsh.
Well, I thought this is why it's great that you have Keith Robinson.
Yeah,
going,
you dummy.
Yeah, why are you talking?
Yeah.
Just says on your,
yeah.
And like that is frightening to people because
it's pure on it. Like if you want to know if you look good in a shirt, call Keith Robinson.
Yeah.
Show it to him, you know.
Well, that was the scene that we're trying to, the scene has softened a little bit, but mm-hmm. especially when I was coming up, it was Patrice and it was Geraldo and Bill Burr.
A lot, but, you know,
and it was Artie and it was these guys and you'd sit down and then make fun of the way the chair squeaked.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And you're just like, I'm going to go home.
Right.
And not perform. It was a scary thing.
Nick DiPaolo and Patrice O'Neill should have had a sitcom. And if they were allowed to do what they did at that table, it'd be great, but they would never be allowed to do it. It was unbelievable.
Yeah, they always try.
Yeah.
They try and do it on, like, Tough Crowd. I remember watching Tough Crowd as a kid and being like, be nice. Stop it.
Yeah, they were hard.
Like, there'd be, like, a Middle Eastern guy, and they'd just be like, are you a terrorist? I'm like, that's inappropriate.
There's an amazing story I could tell about that, but I would have to say a bad word. But as Patrice...
I'm excited.
Sure.
The show hasn't aired yet, Artie. I don't know if Artie banned from HBO. Might be the return appearance here joke.
I'm going to say a bad word, but I have to say it to tell the story.
Okay. Why don't you have Pete say it?
Just push his finger when you want.
Okay. Patrice had to go for a physical one day, and everybody at the table knew he was going for a physical. It was like news. And he came back, and he was sitting right across from Nick DiPaolo. And Nick, even if he was saying something touching, it was like he was stabbing with a dagger. He went, so how was your physical? How was your physical? And Patrice said, man, I got 7 out of 10 things that kill niggas. Without missing a beat, Nick goes, one of them a handgun? All right. Keith Robinson was sitting right here. He laughed. He started to laugh. As he laughed harder, he went this way with his body. He went, everybody at the table just guffawed at that because that's what it was. It was pure honesty. It was racial. It was sexual. It was everybody fucked with anything in your life. And Patrice is like, you know, being funny about the fact that he might die, and he has, which makes it insanely crazy, the story. But Nick was that quick with that and didn't care about saying something that offensive because that was the one universe where you could do it.
Well, I think that's what makes comedians so fun. It's not always necessarily something that's racial or charged in that way, but they make fun of everything.
Right.
So when my wife left me, everybody just jumped right to 3 months later.
That's a hard thing, though.
But it help if you can laugh at it, you can survive it. I don't want to turn this into the Lifetime channel. I'm just saying there is
so that's after my story. I think we can do that.
What's the meanest thing someone said to you at that time?
Well, I remember very vividly right after I found out she was cheating on me, and I hadn't told anybody. I went to a show at the UCB, and I saw a friend of mine, and I was so sad I could barely muster up the words like, "How you doing?" And I was like, "How you doing, man?" And he was like, oh, "I've been pretty good. Just fucking your wife." I was like,
well, in the show. That is hard.
Yeah. But he didn't know, but still, that's how they talked leading up to it.
The first time I went to a roast, I roasted Jack Black for the Friars Club. The first time I went to a roast after I stabbed myself. Sarah is sitting next to me and said, how are you? I haven't seen you. I'm like, I'm all right, thanks. She goes up there, first joke. Artie, he stabbed himself. He was just trying to get more gravy. Now we're back. Me and Greg Giraldo did a William Shatner roast on Comedy Central. This one had turned. Joel Gallen, the brilliant guy who does those, he took us in by two, and he told us there's one thing Shatner said you can't talk about. William Shatner found his wife dead in a swimming pool, and he's... You can't talk about that. And I was like to myself, and I'm the slob I am, I'm going, who is going to talk about that? I would never bring that up. I looked at Geraldo, and he clearly had 20 minutes on his wife in the swimming pool.
That's so good. But there comes a point with comedians that the insult is not insulting them.
Right.
We just did a Jim Norton show down the hall, and Artie and I were breaking each other's balls, and I still feel weird doing that to Artie. But then he's like, that's what you do.
Well, I grew up and, you know, my God, that was a term of affection. It was like, you know, nobody said anything positive to me ever.
That's right.
To this day.
Yeah. And we grew up in different worlds, but my dad was, you know, he's an oil man. He comes home head to toe in filth, and he works with mechanics and all those types of guys. And I would go to work with him, and I never knew how to make those guys laugh until like later in life. Well, now I just do an impression of them. I'm just like, that's the only way I can get them. But you could make them laugh.
I'll give you this, to that, the best Greg Giraldo story is, I mean, me and Greg, of course, shared demons, and I do miss him dearly. That was the finality of him. Like, I went to the Comedy Cellar once. The last time I saw him was he was sitting across from me there, and when he was dead, I was like, he's gone. He's not in Milwaukee on a gig. He's not with his wife. He's gone. And we both did the Shatner roast. Okay. I'm at the first class JFK, part of JFK, waiting for Geraldo. He's the only other guy coming from New York City. He shows up. He had been on a 3-day bender. And he goes, Art, I'm tweaked out. I don't know why. I can't get on the plane. I mean, you have to get on the plane. This is your career. He was killing so hard at these roasts. I said, you can't do this. So I had Vicodin on me. And I said, take the Vicodin. You'll come down, have a beer. I changed my seat on the plane to sit next to him. I held his hand. He couldn't go to the bathroom without anxiety. I watched the bathroom like a bouncer for him. We got to L.A. I went in the same town car as him. I slept and put compresses on his forehead. We went to dress rehearsal. I stood next to him at dress rehearsal. He wasn't out of it yet the next day. I said, what were you doing? He was a bad combination of shit. All speed. Finally, he comes out of the bathroom at 4 a.m. We had to be at dress rehearsal at 10 a.m. was our call. He said, Art, I'm better. Like, that thing broke, which I related to. And he goes, thanks, man. I go, you would have done it for me. I hugged him. I go, you all right now? Yeah. The taping of the show. He's the first guy. The first fucking joke. He goes, Artie Lang is here. A little applause. He goes, Artie Lang, look at you. You fat fucking drug addict. And I went like this to him anyway.
Wow.
It's a roast, buddy.
Yeah.
And cut to me and Andy Dick with drinks. Yeah, and that was the greatest thing ever. Like, that sums up what a comedian is. You fat fucking drug addict. He's also fat.
And that sums up what the show is. That addresses what I was saying. It's like we help each other while we're making fun of each other.
Well, that great time at the one of the rudest things I say in the show is when Judd let me riff about you going with the stripper, and I said something I can't believe I said, because in real life it's about don't come back till she's fucking your wife. And I said, I can't believe I just said that. But then it shows how people are comfortable around you, because the whole crew laughed. It's like they're comfortable.
Yeah.
That means you're a good person. Yeah. Whoever you're comfortable fucking with is probably a better person to you.
Well,
you know?
God help us. There wasn't a scene that we did where Judd wasn't like, now tell Pete he's not funny. Because there's nothing funnier than going right at the thing that you know you can't. It's in the pilot. My wife has a great line where she's like, you've been doing it for years. Shouldn't you be funnier by now?
Yeah.
And that's what makes me angry. It's not that she fucked another dude. It's that she's like, be better. Next!
Yeah. Like, well, you're comparing it to medical school like you're going to be a doctor, but Artie is the one who points out, you don't know.
You just don't know.
No one does.
Yeah.
It's an odd profession, man.
Yeah. And there's always a weird thing when you see someone when they're young and they're terrible, and that person could be, you know, a person who changes the game later.
Well, I won't name names, but there were a lot of guys that weren't. They were punchline guys. You'd say their name and everyone would be like, yeah, right.
Yeah.
Those guys are some of the best people working today. It's incredible.
Kumail.
I remember we used to tease Hannibal. We'd be like, oh, Hannibal's here. His name is Hannibal. But you'd be like, oh, he's here. And now we're all like, I'm opening for Hannibal.
Right.
You know what I mean? He's one of my absolute favorites. But in the open mic scene, we're all garbage. So yeah. You kind of make fun of each
other. Sebastian Maniscalco was so hot right now. And he talks about for years in L.A. He wasn't getting anything. He was so angry about it, but it just wasn't working for him. And then he found it, whatever it is.
I know. Well, it's that tightrope of, like Greer says in The Pilot, do I quit? Is that the right advice, or do I stick with it? It's like Kid Rock syndrome. Mm-hmm. Like Kid Rock had been doing it 30 years, and then he got a break.
I used to always work with Doug Benson before he smoked pot.
Yeah,
that's a long time ago.
Yeah,
that's folklore. He started smoking pot and like changed his act and gave him a different persona and made him really, really funny.
Well, let me ask you, Pete, if you did this without Judd, what would you be missing? Because it's always
a TV show.
Yeah. Well, but it's that thing where it's hard for people at home when they're watching to know exactly what Judd brings to it that,
well,
you
that's a great question, because I'm being honest, I never knew what a producer did.
Right.
You see, like, it's produced by J.J. Abrams, and I always thought that meant, I'm being serious, they fronted the money. Mm-hmm. So I thought it produced, a show like Girls or this show with Judd as the producer, I just thought it meant he gave its blessing, like an Old Testament marriage. You know what I mean? And instead, it's not. Every outfit, every scene, every story went through Judd. So like I'm saying, I'd be like, I'd write this script with a lot of people talking, because that's what happens in life. And then Judd's like, I think you need to get mugged. You know what I mean? Like something has to, he'd say that to me and go, Pete, something has to happen. You know what I mean? He wouldn't say it angrily.
Right.
But that's what he that's what he brought to the show. I mean, it's literally every scene. He'd be on the set yelling out lines. I was shocked at how involved he was. Even when he wasn't there, I'd call him before a big scene, and he'd tell me not only like what to do, but like what to say, and like sometimes if it's not working, do this and do this. It was insane. He's like the co-writer, co-director of everything we did.
And you got so many projects.
I know, that's insane. It'd be on the other line. He's like, I'm on the other line with Seinfeld. I'm like, okay, I'll hold.
Yeah,
when Judd is on the phone, I almost want to go up to him and say, I'm just curious, what part of your life are you dealing with right now? Is it personal? Is it one of the 82 projects? Are you talking about my outfit?
Is that fun for you, though, Judd, to have so many of these plates spinning? Or?
Well, it's, I mean, last year it stacked up because we were shooting the last season of Girls. We were shooting Pete's show, and then we were shooting Love, the second season of Love, for Netflix, which comes out middle of March.
Jeez.
And so it just, a lot was happening. My brain was spinning. But you know, if you have great writers and great directors and collaborators like Pete and Paul Rust and Lena, you can do it, and you're part of a larger machine. So it's possible. But I'm glad there's only two this year.
Well, you produced an off-Broadway play, right?
Yes. I mean, it's a funny story, is that I didn't know who Pete was, but I was doing the premiere of Girls at South by Southwest 5 years ago, and I'm friends with his manager, Dave Rath, and he said, do you want to do Pete's podcast? And I said, okay, just for him. And it was at a comedy club, and the other guests were Kumail Nanjiani and Chris Gethard. And now 5 years later, I just did Kumail's movie, The Big Sick, and we just shot Career Suicide, Chris's one-man show for HBO this past weekend, which is going to be on in May.
It was incredible.
So it was just a very productive podcast.
It's the most productive podcast of all time.
I feel like I'm going to get no new projects out of this.
Yeah, you're already working with both of us. Yeah.
It's why I can never fire my manager.
Crashing premieres Sunday, February 19th.
He's listening to this.
You know, that reminded me of when I'd bomb with a joke during Robin's news, and there'd be nothing, and Howard would go, what else, Robin? It was the worst part of my day.
Yeah. What a perfect name for another book for you, dude.
What else, Robin? That's right. Oh, wow.
Again, I just want to...
What else, Robin?
This thing is terrific. It's really, really funny, and there's so many great comics in it that some of them just, like... The fact that you guys captured Big J and his street sense.
That's something.
Dan Natterman.
Yeah, almost Dan Natterman is hilarious.
I would script things that Jay said to me when I was 25.
Yeah.
Like I would, because they were that horrible and shocking. And then I had him saying them again. So very realistic for sure.
Yeah, Big J's a perfect example of comedy. He's like that, but he's such a sweet guy.
I know.
Insanely funny. Insanely.
And again, he's a very sensitive guy, like most comedians. All these toughest comedians that you're talking about, there's a soft underbelly there.
When you do the road with somebody, like I've Jay came out with me a couple of times, and you have lunch on a Saturday afternoon in Milwaukee. You talk, and it's great, actually. You find out why they're funny. You know,
that is the thing, and it comes up in this, that the closeness that you get with somebody being on the road. I mean, you're ready to take a bullet for him.
Yeah.
Because suddenly this thing that becomes to the 10th power.
You're so happy to get a job that I would turn down now. You know what I'm saying? Like, you, please let me go to the scariest club and open for people that I'm not ready to face. And you're so happy for the opportunity. That's an insane world. That's what I love to explore.
Yeah.
Well, it's a great show. I'm going to say it again. It's Crashing Sunday, February 19th, 10:30 on HBO. Thanks so much, guys.
Thank you very much, Ron. Thank you.
Appreciate it. Best of luck with all this.
Thank you.
Congratulations, buddy, really. Thank you so much, guys.